Love in the age of Trump. Can you actually be in love and love somebody with this monster in the White House? We talked to comedians Angela Cobb and Lance Weiss about love in the age of Trump. David Dayen joins us from The Nation magazine and The Intercept to talk about Dodd-Frank and how Donald Trump's new executive orders are jeopardizing your financial security and making it safe, once again, for vulture capitalists. We got a lot of show. Let's get right to it. DavidFeldmanShow.com. I've lived through a couple of bubbles. We're in a bubble right now. Stock market's hitting 20,000 record highs. There was a time in the 90s when Alan Greenspan warned of irrational exuberance. That's what we had during the Obama administration. Irrational exuberance. What's going on now with Trump is our bubble has been burst. When we're in a bubble, whether it be a stock market bubble, a political bubble, an historical bubble, a psychological bubble, an information bubble, when you're in a bubble, you only hear and see what you want to see. And when the bubble bursts, there's a Newtonian reaction to the irrational exuberance. In other words, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. So when the bubble bursts, that irrational exuberance turns into irrational fear, irrational doomsday predictions, irrational depression, anxiety. Our bubble has been burst. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. We had who I consider to be one of our greatest presidents, Barack Obama. He did the best he could. There was a bubble. We went from the oxygen being sucked out of our economy in 2008, the greatest recession since the Great Depression. Obama became president. Within 9 months, the recession was over. The GDP started to grow very slowly, but jobs came back, but not really. But there was a bubble. We thought things were getting better. In many ways they were, in many ways they weren't. We lived in a bubble. We wanted to believe that things were getting better. But as is the case in everything in the sweep of history, things get better while things get worse. But we believe that things were getting better. A lot of young people with white privilege, young millennials, created this bubble for themselves. Their parents created this bubble. Obama will take care of you. You're safe. Nobody should challenge you. Here's a trophy. Nobody should trigger you. You don't have to learn anything in college that upsets you. Nobody should scold you. We created a generation under Obama of safe zones, of people who wanted to be protected. We created a lot of weak people, a lot of pussies. And bubbles burst. Stock market bubbles burst. Echo chamber bubbles burst. Information bubbles burst. Trump pricked that bubble. Trump pricked our bubble. And now a lot of us are terrified. A lot of us fear that we're going to lose everything because of Donald Trump. I think you have to fight Donald Trump every step of the way. But don't flatter yourself, America. Don't think for one second that Donald Trump took this once great nation and is wringing all the goodness out of it. Don't flatter yourself. There's been some bad stuff going on before Obama, during Obama. The only difference is Trump doesn't do nuance or subtlety. I've been wrong about Trump every step of the way. I assured everybody he wasn't going to get the nomination. I assured everybody he wasn't going to be elected president. But one of the things I did say when he got the nomination is the Republican Party deserves Donald Trump. The chicken hawks have come home to roost. This is who the Republican Party is. They are Donald Trump, a party of hucksters who will say and do anything for their own financial gain. They're willing to believe anything so long as they get rich. And Trump got the nomination. Everybody said, oh, it's the end of the Republican Party. Remember? Remember how everybody was saying in the lead up to Hillary's coronation? Remember how everybody was saying, well, Donald Trump has ruined the Republican Party. They will never recover. They're splintered. Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about how successful the Republican Party is and how it's the Democrats who are in trouble. The Democrats are splintering. So maybe Trump will do to America what he did to the Republican Party. And by that I mean, right now we're saying he's dividing the country. He's destroying our country the same way he was destroying and dividing the Republican Party. And I'm saying, you know what? It's not just the Republican Party that deserved Donald Trump. I'm beginning to believe America deserves Donald Trump. We brought this on by living in our own little bubble. The Republican Party is stronger and more powerful than ever, probably because of Donald Trump. So maybe, just maybe, on today's show, I'm going to be optimistic and say, maybe Donald Trump is the best thing that could ever happen to America. Yes, he's dung. He's our common enemy. But maybe he's doing us a favor. Or maybe we have to get into a mindset where instead of being frightened, we enjoy him a little bit and thank him and have a little elegance and finesse in battling him and confidence and some perspective, and we start to think, we caused this. Our greed, our willingness to let Obama tuck us in at night and feel safe and secure and believe his lies and believe the lies about who we are as a people. Maybe we caused this. Maybe Trump is telling us who we are as a people. He's telling us the other side of the coin, and it isn't pretty. And we're being forced to look in the mirror and see how ugly this country has been and can be. And you can change it. I don't believe in utopias. I believe in the truth. I believe in tallying up the good and the bad, pluses and the minuses, and dealing in the truths. And Trump, as much as he lies, you know, occasionally he says some truths. Here's what you have to do. I'm getting tired of people calling me, I'm depressed. The country is, we're going to turn into Nazi Germany. We're not turning into Nazi Germany. We're already where we are. This is who we are. We're human beings. No matter what kind of government they set up, we're always going to be human beings. So what if you approach this crisis, and it is a crisis, and we have to get rid of Trump. What if you approach this from the standpoint of self-interest? Talking about yourself, you. What's in it for you? How do you approach politics? You approach politics, you approach government through self-interest. You get up every morning and you do Maslow's hierarchy of needs. How am I doing? I need money. I need security. I need safety. I need jobs. I need equality. I need dignity. I need clean air. I need potable water. That's how you approach it. Because if you need it, so do other people. You should not be letting the news coming out of Washington affect your sleeping, your eating, your anxiety, how much you exercise? Because these are the things you can control. When you get a good night's sleep, when you're eating properly, when you're exercising, you're taking care of yourself. And when you're taking care of yourself, then you're prepared to take care of others. And the way you take care of others, pursuing your self-interest, the same way Rex Tillerson, who's now Secretary of State, pursued his own self-interests by hiring lobbyists who would funnel campaign funds to senators and congressmen if they would agree to pipelines and fracking for Exxon. Pursue your own self-interests, but pursue them wisely. What can you control? You're not God. You can control how you treat yourself, how you treat others, and you speak out wisely. You're prudent. Take a page from Bono. Bono sings, he writes great music. He met with Jesse Helms. Senator Jesse Helms was a horrible bigot, a segregationist from the South. But when Jesse Helms was interested in funding the fight against AIDS in Africa, Bono met with him. Bono met with George W. Bush. And it turns out that George W. Bush, as bad as he was, did more to combat AIDS in Africa than any president since the epidemic first reared its head in the 80s. Bono, who's a saint, Bono, greatest human being on the planet, he'll meet with the devil. Do what Bono does. Keep your mouth shut. You don't have to wear your politics on your sleeve all the time. You don't have to show up at parties or at work saying, "Oh, Trump, I can't believe Trump. What are we going to do?" Because most of that is grandstanding. It's saying, "Hey, look at me, everybody. I, more than anybody else, look how much I care. I can't get past our president. I'm so sensitive. I bleed for the planet." Screw you. Just shut up. Nobody wants to hear it. Call your congressman. Call your senator. Do your job. Don't discuss politics at work. Right now, discussing politics at work or at a party, it's like discussing irritable bowel syndrome that you can't shake. Nobody wants to hear it right now. What are you doing? What are you doing? If you're doing something, if you're going to a protest, if you're calling your congressman, then I'm interested. I'm not interested in your anxiety. You sound like a pampered millennial whose bubble got burst, who graduated from the University of New Hampshire, some whiny little bitch from an Ivy League school where there were safe zones and you didn't have to learn what triggered something. And all of a sudden, you're working for a living and the boss talked to you in a way that triggered the way your mother used to talk to you or the way your father used to talk to you. And that brought up bad feelings. Grow a set of balls, America. Nobody's asked you to do anything. After 9/11, you were asked to shop. You weren't asked to pay taxes. You weren't asked to fight. You weren't asked to do anything other than shop and appreciate peak TV. So grow a set of balls and stop whining about Donald Trump. Conserve your energy. Calm down. We've been here before, and we will always be here. We will always be here. The fight is always there. The fight has always been there for black people, for gay people, for farm workers, for women. The fight has always been there. The fear has always been there. Some of us are feeling it for the first time. The way some of us felt it for the first time in October of 2008, when the economy crashed. But we conveniently forgot that feeling, didn't we? And thought it was nothing but blue skies. black people, gay people, transgender people, Latinos, Muslims in America, women. They didn't forget it. They didn't forget it. So calm down. We've been here before. And maybe we should stay here. Maybe this time we should stay here. Alert, anxious, calm, and politically involved. Stop telling me about what's on Netflix. It's garbage. What's on Hulu is garbage. When the comedy explosion broke in the 80s, Jerry Seinfeld was being interviewed, and he said, in America, there have always been five great comedians. We have a lot more comedians now that there's a comedy explosion, but there are still only five great comedians. We're having this peak TV, golden age of television right now. I think there's like something like 400 hours, 600 hours of scripted television in 2016. How much of that is really fantastic, and how much of that are you being marketed to, being convinced that it's fantastic? You know, I've got the Writers Guild Awards coming up, and I went to the Emmys. The dirty, dark secret is that the people in the industry don't watch TV. They don't have time. Who's watching all this stuff? And why? Why are you watching all this stuff? Because if you're paying attention to the new Fuller House, you're not paying attention to the Republican House. There was a time when people would say, it's my guilty pleasure to watch Fuller House or to watch the Gilmore Girls. There are people getting really pissed off at me for complaining about the Gilmore Girls. My mother watches the new Gilmore Girls, right? My mother watches the new Gilmore Girls and says it's fantastic and we need it. I'm sure we do. I'm sure we do. But there are only so many hours in the day. There's no such thing as utopia. You will survive Trump. As bad as it's going to get, most of you will survive Trump. Most of you survived Iraq. The Iraqis didn't, but most of us survived Iraq. We rounded up the Japanese in World War II, except for the soldiers. Most Americans survived World War II. We're nations inside of nations, bubbles inside of bubbles. There's a limit to how totalitarian a regime can be set up here in the States. And as much as I believe in a strong federal government, there is value to states' rights. There is value to not really having a national police force, to having individual police chiefs. There is value to each state having its own national guard. There is value to every state being a laboratory of democracy, because it is a check and a balance on somebody like Donald Trump. Yes, I believe in states' rights. So calm down. This is not Nazi Germany. We're not suddenly going to be under the iron grip of Ceausescu. This is a new thing, and we will determine what it's going to be. We will determine what it's going to be, and it's happening quickly because it always happens quickly. The first 100 days of any presidency is where you get all your work done. That's when you introduce all the big pieces of legislation. That's where you set your compass points, your coordinates. That's where you start steering the ship. Because after 100 days, all your ideas have to be funded. The hearings begin. Press, the media starts examining you. So, yes, there is a blitzkrieg, a lot of chaos. They're moving quickly because that's how it's done. You move quickly and try to push as much as you can and ask for the moon, because the system is set up to thwart your every move. There has never been a president who was able to push through everything he wanted. Certainly not FDR. If you go back, there's this myth that FDR was able to push through all these changes. He moved quickly and he did get things done. It was in fits and starts. The first 100 days was where he really shined, you know, shutting down the banks. Johnson was able to really move quickly. The reason Johnson and FDR were able to move so quickly is they had the will of the people behind them. People wanted the New Deal under Roosevelt. People wanted a great society under Johnson. The Civil Rights Act. There was marching in the streets. People were marching in Selma. As Roosevelt said to the far left, make me do it. And the far left made him do it. The far left made Johnson do it. And Bannon understands this. According to the New York Times, Steve Bannon is telling his friends that there's a brief window to push as much of their white nationalist, anti-Muslim, extremist views into the White House before his head's on a stick. He knows his head's on a stick eventually. Robert Reich, the former Secretary of Labor, you should read him. And by the way, he was on the Ralph Nader Radio Hour last week, which I recommend that everybody listen to. It's a show that I do with Steve Scrovan and Ralph Nader. Robert Reich gives some great advice. He says, he wrote over the weekend, don't get caught up in the minutiae. This is how you stay focused and remove all the clutter from your mind. Because people like Steve Bannon are merchants of chaos. They want your head spinning. They don't want you focused. Robert Reich says, don't pay attention to Neil Gorsuch, the new Supreme Court justice. Focus on Trump. Make sure that you're not normalizing the Trump presidency. He says the Democrats should not be voting on Gorsuch's nomination until Trump's legitimacy as a president is established. He says that Pelosi and Schumer should be forcing intelligence committees to look into whether or not Russian operatives were responsible for Trump's electoral victory. Reich says, delegitimate Trump. Demand that he release his taxes, that he put his assets into a blind trust. Robert Reich writes, quote, Trump is the issue here as well as the integrity of our democracy. Focus. Yes, you have to pay attention to all the nominees and try to block them. Reich isn't saying ignore everything else that Trump is doing, but you have to focus. You have to be specific. Focus on Trump. Remind him that he's not a legitimate president, that he lost the popular vote by 3 million, that it was 70,000 votes in three swing states that gave him the presidency, that the Russians hacked the DNC and leaked secrets to embarrass Hillary Clinton. They also hacked the RNC, but didn't release any secrets to embarrass Donald Trump. Focus on that, says Robert Reich. Make sure the White House is told that they are not legitimate. It's a boxing match. The human skeleton has about 206 bones. We start off with about 270 bones and then they fuse together. But when you get into a boxing ring, you're fighting somebody with 206 bones. You cannot break every bone. You want to. What do? If you start focusing on all 206 bones, you're not going to know where to throw a punch. But in boxing, you're trained to work the body and work the head. Certain parts of the body, certain parts of the head, that's what you do. You focus on two areas. You focus on the head and the body. Focus on what's right in front of your nose. Is the TV in front of your nose? That's not going to help. This is how you're going to fight. You're going to fight quietly. You're not going to scream at people. You're not going to bring your psychological issues into the political theater. You're not going to go online and troll Republicans, because you're not winning their minds when you fight online. Are you sharing information? Are you thinking? Are you having a personal connection with people? Are you having a conversation? Do you know how to have a conversation? Do you know how to exchange ideas? Do you know how to talk to somebody who may not agree with you 100%? Do you know how to share knowledge? Or do you have to alpha dog every conversation so the conversation becomes nothing more than a public display of how smart you are? Most Americans don't know how to have a conversation. Most Americans steer a conversation into what they know or into what they believe. Most Americans that I talk with have learned to change the subject so that the gaps in their knowledge are never revealed. Because we've become a nation of con artists, which is why Donald Trump is our president. If you don't know something, or if the conversation turns uncomfortable, change the subject. It's what's going on in our colleges. If teaching you something makes you feel uncomfortable, we won't teach it to you. It's okay not to know something. It's okay to be a little ashamed of not knowing something. It's not okay to be proud of your ignorance the way so many Trump supporters are proud of their ignorance, their lack of education. It's not okay to not want to teach. I know a lot of liberals, a lot of feminists who have said to me, if you don't know, I'm not going to teach you. It's for you to find out. I'm too angry to explain to you why that behavior is unacceptable. It's not okay to be ignorant, and it's not okay not to be willing to teach the ignorant. Knowledge is infinite. The internet never ends. You will never reach the end of the internet. You'll never reach the end of the universe. You'll never wake up one day and say, I know everything. You don't even know what you know. You don't know what you don't know. And more importantly, when you're having a conversation with people, you don't know what you know. So when you listen to other people, they could teach you or remind you of what you forgot you knew. Have quiet conversations with people you trust. Who is a person you trust? A person you trust is somebody who's trying to arrive at a decision calmly. If you want to win, if you want to defeat Trump, you need to work methodically. You need silence. You need to figure out what's best for you. Take care of yourself first. Focus on what you need from the government, what you need from politics. And what you need is, more than anything else, universal health insurance. That's where everybody should start. Universal health insurance. The merchants of chaos, they want you fighting, shouting, screaming. They don't want you in a contemplative mode. Most of my friends, they're upset. Most people are skimming the news. They're not reading the news. But it's on. It's on in the background. CNN is blasting. MSNBC is blasting. I can't miss a thing. I need my alerts. I need my alerts. I need to. Breaking news. Breaking this just in. I remember when my grandfather passed away. He had been in the hospital. And they called my grandmother, and he died at 3 a.m. And my grandmother was in her apartment when he passed away. And my grandmother, who was an immigrant, survived God knows what in Eastern Europe, said to the nurse who called her to tell her that her husband had passed away, she said, "Why are you calling me at 3 a.m? Now I can't get back to sleep." And I never forgot that. I never forgot that. My grandmother was in her 80s at the time. "Why are you calling me at 3 a.m? Now I'm not going to get back to sleep." The love of her life had just passed away. There was nothing she could do. It wasn't as though at 3 a.m. she was going to go down to the hospital. The point she was making was, it could have waited till morning. I'm not a doctor. I'm not God. I couldn't save him. I guess some people would find that bizarre. I've never forgotten it, because what do you know, and when do you need to know certain things? How much do you need to know, and when do you need to know it? Would my grandfather have been any less dead if the nurse waited 5 more hours and let my grandmother sleep? Do you really need to have CNN blasting with the breaking news, with the urgency, nonstop? You know, before CNN, I remember the term, "I'm a news junkie." That was when I was growing up. I used to hear that. "I'm a news junkie." Junkies were heroin addicts. "Ah, it's my fix. I need the news. I need the news." Well, what does a news junkie mean? News junkie means you need your fix. It means you need the shot, the adrenaline, the jolt. If you're a news junkie, you're addicted to the news. Addicted to the jolt, the adrenaline. It feels good. And if you don't get it, you crash. You don't care. You don't really care about what's going on. You like the rush and the action. It's like gambling. That's why you have CNN and MSNBC blasting. You really don't care what's going on. It's your caffeine. It makes your blood boil. You need it. You're a junkie. So turn off your TV. There's no such thing as breaking news. Breaking news is 9/11. What do you need to know, and when do you need to know it? If you need to know everything right now, then you know nothing. If all it is breaking news, then you have no perspective. You have no understanding. Get off the electronic devices. Paper books, magazines, paper. Listen to the radio. Listen to podcasts. There's a thing called the slow news movement now. The Columbia School of Journalism has a monthly magazine that's great. And I was reading about the slow news movement. And it's basically like the slow food movement. Mindfulness. Go slowly and pay attention. You don't need to go to every website. Isolate and get rid of the clutter. Marie Kondo, she's the Japanese clutter-clearing guru. You know where she had her come-to-Jesus moment? I was reading about her. She said she realized the power of removing clutter when she was organizing bookshelves, when she was organizing books in her high school. And she fainted. She was so overwhelmed by all the books in the school library that needed organization that she fainted, and then dedicated her life to removing clutter from her home. How do you face all this clutter? Well, you have to trust real news. You have to trust a couple of responsible news organizations and get rid of the clutter. I'm overwhelmed by it. I remember Ralph Nader telling me he can't start his day unless he reads the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, and the Washington Post cover to cover. I can't do that. That's overwhelming to me. Then there's the internet. Then there's the Daily Kos and BBC and The Nation, Talking Points Memo. There's so much to get to. How do you do it? The dumbest thing to do is to turn on the TV and think that that's the most efficient way to get news. If you turn on the TV, if you turn on CNN or MSNBC, except for Rachel Maddow, all you're going to get is the same story over and over again. The hour that you invest in anesthetizing yourself in front of Wolf Blitzer, you can actually spend reading the New York Times cover to cover. You're just going to get anxious, frightened, belligerent, listening to the news, to the same story being repeated over and over again. How do you read the newspaper? How would you even approach? How would you even begin to read the Washington Post, the New York Times, and the Wall Street Journal every day? Which, by the way, if you did that, you would know more than you need to know. How do you do that? On my good days, the way I would do that, and I've never done that, I've never read the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal cover to cover. But the way I, on my good days, when I'm focused, I approach these newspapers by saying to myself, all right, I'm going to read the first paragraph of every story in this newspaper. That's all I have to do because of the inverted pyramid. In journalism, the inverted pyramid is you put the most important information up front. Who, what, where, when, why, how is revealed in the first paragraph of every story. And as you read the story, the less important information is revealed to you. That's the way journalists write. Good journalists write. The first paragraph has the most important information in it. By the time you get to the end of the story, they're anecdotes. Color. At least that's the way stories used to be written. Now I've noticed they start off with color. They'll start off with an anecdote, the story of one person. I can't stand that. That's why I like The Economist. Economist, very short articles. They get to the point, no color. What I hate is there's a travel ban from seven Muslim nations, and the story starts with Abdul Salim lives in a small village in Syria. What's with the travel ban? I don't need to know about Abdul Salim. So that's how you plow through a newspaper. Most of these stories don't begin with color. They begin with facts. If you start off reading the first paragraph of every story in a newspaper, you have a better chance of plowing through the entire paper than trying to tackle each story from beginning to middle to end. If you read the first paragraph of every story in the paper and something catches your interest along the way, by all means, read it. But if you want to read the New York Times, the entire New York Times, in an hour, just read the first paragraph of every story. I don't do this. I try to. I view the magazines and the newspapers that come to me, either through my Kindle or my mailbox, as reading assignments. The millennials I meet don't. I don't know if this is good or bad. There's a part of me that admires them. They are not overwhelmed. They don't feel that the New York Times is an assignment because I think they have this sense of entitlement. I'm sorry, this is probably jealousy of youth, but I think a lot of millennials view the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal as I'll just take what I want from it. I don't need anybody telling me what I need to know. I'll decide what's worth knowing. I'll skim this paper, and if something strikes my fancy, I'll read it. I kind of like that. I think that's a virtue to approach the internet and a newspaper that way, as opposed to my generation and my parents' generation, where you walk into their homes and it's like the Collier brothers. The Collier brothers were this family. When they died, they found their apartment was just stacked with newspapers and magazines that they were meaning to get to. You all have grandparents, you all have parents, you all have friends who have National Geographics from 1993 that they're going to get to. You're not going to get to it. Throw it out. So I do admire that in millennials, that they don't get intimidated by the magazines and the books. I'll take from it what I want, and if I'm not interested, it's not important. It's what drives me crazy about millennials, but it is a healthy way to do what I call intellectual triage. The magazine arrives. You have to decide, what am I going to read? What am I not going to read? There is a virtue to that kind of confidence to perform that kind of intellectual triage where you look at a story and say, I'm not interested in this. I'm not reading it. I don't need to know it. What the Times is doing lately is they literally have columns called What You Need to Know. And if the Times says this is what you need to know it. They're brief synopses of what you need to know. I recommend going to the Times. I recommend subscribing to their app. Their app, the style of writing in the New York Times has changed, less stodgy, and they're no longer treating news as though it's a soap opera and it's your responsibility to come up to speed. They are going out of their way now to have links to bring you up to speed on issues you know nothing about. There's an article in the New York Review of Books by Bill McKibben. By the way, the New York Review of Books, it comes out every 2 weeks. It's a great magazine. It does book reviews, but it also publishes essays on the news that are insightful, very reminiscent of the self-indulgent years of The New Yorker before Tina Brown took it over. I find The New Yorker much more readable these days. It's more fun. Some would say it's a little too well-written, a little too punchy, but I remember it when I was a kid. It was unreadable. My parents used to subscribe to it, and it would pile up. Nobody would read it. So The New Yorker has become readable. The New York Review of Books, I recommend it. More thoughtful essays. And Bill McKibben has a review of a book called The Revenge of Analog, Real Things and Why They Matter. It's written by David Sachs, published by Public Affairs. The book is about the vanquishing of digital, that more and more humans are discovering moleskins. Instead of going face down into their iPhone to write something down, they're carrying little pads. They are listening to vinyl, dropping to their knees and putting vinyl on a record player because vinyl sounds better. And there's a mindfulness to putting something on the record player and stopping and listening to a song, not being able to press a button to get rid of that song if you stumble into an area where you don't like the song. I'm guilty of this. If I plow through music now, I listen to the first 15 seconds of every song. If I don't like it, I move on. It's hard to discover art if the minute something is uncomfortable or boring, you turn away from it. I doubt there are many concept albums coming out these days because the minute it gets heavy, you just hit forward, right? Bill McKibben writes about the moleskin. A little notebook selling point, he says, is that you can't use it to look up stock futures or to swipe right or play solitaire. It concentrates, not dissipates, the mind. What if Picasso had had Snapchat? What if Hemingway had spent half the afternoon writing Yelp reviews of his favorite bars? He goes on to say that ebook sales are beginning to slow and that magazines are coming back. The Economist has seen print subscriptions grow by 600,000 in the past 10 years, even though it costs $150 a year to subscribe. They've gained 600,000 subscriptions in a decade. The New York Times is gaining new print subscribers. The deputy editor of The Economist attributes a lot of these subscriptions to younger people seeking status as readers of The Economist, but it's also what they call a social signifier. This is something I had said 2 weeks ago. You used to walk into somebody's apartment and see their albums and their books and know who they were. The deputy editor of The Economist tells Bill McKibben in the New York Review of Books, quote, you can't show others you're reading it with a digital edition. You can't leave your iPad lying around to show how smart you are. And then McKibben says that in the book by David Sachs, The Revenge of Analog, Sachs says the virtue of a magazine, the virtue of a newspaper is it has, quote, finishability. This is great. Finishability, quote, a defined beginning, middle, and an end. It doesn't spool on forever the way the web does. McKibben then quotes the guy from The Economist. He says, we're selling the feeling of being smarter when you get to the end. It's the catharsis of finishing. See? That's great. The catharsis of finishing. A beginning, a middle, and an end. The internet never ends. CNN never ends, which means your day never ends, which means your mind never slows down. That's why you're anxious. That's why you can't sleep. That's why you can't take time to exercise or cook the right meal. Because what's the point of exercising? Why should I waste valuable time exercising or reading a novel when there's breaking news on the Muslim ban? When you go back to books and newspapers and paper, finishability. A defined beginning, middle, and end. You know how I stopped drinking? I taught myself that each day has a beginning, a middle, and an end. I never wanted the party to stop. So I would drink. I wanted to turn my mind off. So I would drink. Well, I was able to turn my mind off and get the party to stop by saying, you know what? You need 8 hours of sleep. The day ends at 11. When does this day begin? When does it end? And I have been sober for longer than most of you have been alive. That's how you approach knowledge. With books, magazines, newspapers that have finishability. I love that expression. This is from a review of The Revenge of Analog, Real Things and Why They Matter by David Sachs, an article written by Bill McKibben. And Sachs uses the term in his book, finishability. Have you ever finished the internet? You're never going to finish the internet. That's why you're anxious. That's why you can't sleep. That's why you can't focus. That's why you're being overwhelmed by merchants of chaos like Steve Bannon. Well, there's some good news. I do believe that a lot of us are focused. We're anxious, but we're, you know, focusing on what's important. That is recognizing that Donald Trump is dangerous, and we're calling our congressman, and we're protesting. Protesting is a great way not to feel isolated, not to feel alone, to be with other people. It's also a cheap date. You know, guys, if you want to come across as caring and sensitive and strong, take your date to a protest. A lot of people got laid in the 60s. Love is getting out of yourself. When you go to a protest, you realize there's something bigger than you, the bulge in your pants. There is some good news coming down the pike. Vincent Viola was supposed to be Secretary of the Army. He's a billionaire friend of Trump. He had to withdraw his name last Friday because the pressures mounted. He had business ties that he could not get rid of certain businesses the way Donald Trump is supposed to. And so Vincent Viola, who Donald Trump wanted to be Secretary of Army, gone. On Monday, 97 companies, mostly leading technology companies, have filed a friend of the court briefing coming out against the ban, the executive order banning refugees from 7 predominantly Muslim countries. 97 companies say that it would be bad for business. In this brief, they say that the travel ban would hurt business, and it's unconstitutional. Microsoft, Apple, and Facebook, who signed on to this legal brief saying that the ban is unconstitutional and bad for business, not putting their name to the brief, were Oracle, which is a database company. They might be gunning for business from the Trump administration. If there's going to be a Muslim registry, maybe Oracle feels they can get the business. Hewlett-Packard didn't sign on to the brief. I believe they're run these days by Meg Whitman. She ran for governor of California and lost to Jerry Brown racist son at Princeton. I'll talk about that some other time. Meg Whitman, horrible, horrible kids. And Elon Musk wouldn't sign on to that. Elon Musk is part of Donald Trump's economic roundtable. Elon Musk makes the Tesla and SpaceX, and he's an immigrant, and he's staying on the economic roundtable to advise Donald Trump. CEO of Uber stepped away because of pressure. But Elon Musk is staying because he's saying, why should Trump only be surrounded by extremists? That he's doing the country a favor by being a moderate and advising Trump. No, you're not. Just let the extremists feed on each other. You cannot work with evil. More good news. The Republicans had huge plans to privatize Medicare. We don't seem to be hearing about that now. The drive to repeal Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, is slowing down. Donald Trump gave an interview with Bill O'Reilly during the Super Bowl and said that he doesn't see any repealing or replacement of Obamacare for at least a year. That's slowing down. Matthew Iglesias, in, I believe it was The Intercept, says that protesters have succeeded by convincing House Republicans not to gut the Congressional Ethics Office. He says that the Veterans Administration, due to protests, was granted an exemption from Donald Trump's hiring freeze. 500,000 green card holders were exempted from Donald Trump's executive order, his travel ban, because of protests. The executive order was altered because of protests to grant exemptions to Iraqis who work with the military. They're allowed into the country. Iglesias says that the Republican plan for a massive sell-off of public lands has been canceled because of protests. The protests are getting bigger and bigger. The CEO of Disney, Robert Iger, who has been pretty silent on Donald Trump, canceled a visit to the White House, mysteriously. People like Trump and Putin love motorcycle gangs. They're like the fifth column. They're their brown shirts. Putin rides with motorcycle gangs in Russia because they're looking for a fight. And Trump loves his motorcycle gangs. They were doing security during the inauguration. Echoes of Altamont. He was going to thank his motorcycle gangs by visiting Harley-Davidson in Wisconsin. But he had heard that the protests were going to be massive, so he canceled his trip to Wisconsin to visit his friends at Harley-Davidson. All of a sudden, Obamacare is popular. Because the left is interrupting town halls and getting the word out, affordable care is doing better in the polls now than it was during the election. Suddenly, people are realizing what exactly Obamacare is, and they don't want to lose it. A new poll by the Washington Post released last week says that 25% of all Americans say they plan to be politically active this year. So the protests are working. People are speaking up. The New York Times is reporting that the White House not only ferments chaos outside of the executive office building, there's a lot of chaos within the White House. The New York Times writes that inside the White House, inside the Oval Office, they know that the Muslim ban is a disaster. They are putting checks and balances on Steve Bannon. There are reports that Donald Trump was enraged that Steve Bannon is being called President Bannon. He tweeted at 4 a.m. Monday morning that pretty much said, I'm in charge, not Steve Bannon. Steve Bannon made the cover of Time magazine. Trump was upset about that. Trump does not like sharing the spotlight. He does not play well with others. The New York Times also reports that Trump is enraged because he signed an executive order last week putting Steve Bannon of the National Security Council, head of the CIA, after the executive order was signed. Then they put the CIA on it, but the Joint Chiefs of Staff are not on the National Security Council, but Steve Bannon is. Well, it turns out Trump didn't know what he was signing, and after he signed it and the press revealed that Steve Bannon would be sitting on the National Security Council, Trump reportedly blew up at Steve Bannon. Steve Bannon will be the head on the stick. Eventually, he's going to have to offer up some red meat to everybody, and it will be Steve Bannon who he's going to get rid of, because it's easy to hate Steve Bannon. And that's why Steve Bannon is moving so quickly, because Steve Bannon is evil, but he's smart, and he knows his days are limited. This is all good news. These are not the activities of a fascist regime. There are checks and balances at work. I've been wrong about Trump every step of the way. And I could be wrong here, but I do see cracks. I do see him crumbling. And I do see Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell and the Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, both Republicans, both showing deference to Donald Trump. I think what they're doing is they're saying, let him have his day. Give him his first 100 days. Let him sign these executive orders. Let him feel like he's in charge. And then after 100 days, let's see him implement all this stuff. Some of the stuff they will implement, because McConnell and Paul Ryan are evil sons of a bitches. But I don't see a coup d'etat. I don't see Trump seizing the military and seizing the halls of Congress, Steve Bannon taking over the country. It's just not going to happen. That I don't see happening. Then again, I've been wrong about everything. And we have to be vigilant. If we're not vigilant, it could happen. Although, I don't think Trump wants it. I don't even think Steve Bannon wants it. I think they want to implement some policies and then get on with their lives. Kellyanne Conway apologized about the Bowling Green massacre reference. It's good news because she apologized. The alternative universe, the alternative facts, seem to be coming to an end. When Kellyanne Conway goes on MSNBC's Chris Matthews show, refers to two Iraqi refugees as the masterminds behind the Bowling Green massacre, and it turns out that the Bowling Green massacre never happened, and then the internet lights up and humiliates Kellyanne Conway, she did issue a correction. That's important. When the purveyors of alternative truth start fact-checking themselves, it means they are willing to work with the media and reality. The Trump White House has also backed off on its plan to reopen black site prisons overseas. These were in operation during the George W. Bush administration. That's where the CIA tortured terrorism suspects. Donald Trump, in his first couple of days in office, said those black sites were coming back. Now, the White House has circulated a memo from the National Security Council saying that there will be no secret CIA prisons. Nordstrom dropped Ivanka. Nordstrom dropped all of Ivanka Trump's branded wares from their shelves. Neiman Marcus has stopped selling Ivanka Trump's jewelry due to falling sales. All Trump really has is his name. If you want to punish Trump, you got to ruin the name. Trump could have been destroyed during his bankruptcies, but the bankers realized the Trump name had some kind of value to it. And that's what kept Trump going, was the Trump name. We have to make Trump synonymous with feces. You have to start using phrases like a steaming pile of Trump. I got Trump face last night. Hey, no Trump, Sherlock. That's a Trumpy way to behave. Boy, Kellyanne Conway this morning walked into a real Trump storm. I wouldn't Trump you. Honey, I think the cat's sick. It won't stop Trumping in the tub. I Trumped the bed on that exam. I thought I studied, but I Trumped the bed. That will drive Trump crazy. He is reportedly totally isolated in the White House. He's in his bubble. He has no access to fans. Milani is gone. Baron is gone. He's all alone, reportedly in a bathrobe, walking around the White House. He went down to Mar-a-Lago this past weekend. He was met by 3,000 protesters. Property owners near Mar-a-Lago are hiring private security guards to keep marchers off their property. One resident, one percenter, told the press of the 3,000 protesters, "This is horrible. They should know and respect that this is a quiet residential neighborhood. We are frightened." Oh, so this is a quiet residential neighborhood. 3,000 protesters marched down Flagler Drive, chanting, "Hey, hey, ho, ho, Donald Trump has to go." Well, where were Trump supporters? 30 Trump supporters try to drown out the 3,000 anti-Trump protesters outside Mar-a-Lago, and they were drowned out. A lot of Republican congressmen are getting interrupted at their town hall meetings. A lot of Republicans are being told that they're shocked by the number of pro-Obamacare protesters who show up to the town hall meetings and scream at them. If you want to hurt Donald Trump, the best way, according to Chris Ruddy, he's the chief executive at Newsmax Media, and he's a friend of the president's, he says, it's all about poll numbers. That's all Donald Trump cares about. If the poll numbers go down, says his best friend, Chris Ruddy, Donald Trump's mood will go down. He should be pretty depressed. Donald Trump has the highest disapproval rating of any newly elected president, according to a CNN poll released on Friday. 53% of Americans disapprove of Donald Trump, which is why Donald Trump tweeted on Monday that polls are fake news. Sunday was Super Bowl Sunday, and one of the great myths about Super Bowl Sunday is that it's the number one day for women to get beaten by their husbands. It's a myth. Statistically, that's not true. It's like the myth about December being the number one month for suicides. Most people don't commit suicide in December. Well, I've been saving this story for Super Bowl Sunday because it involves wife beating, and it also involves Andrew Puzder, who you may remember is Donald Trump's pick to be Secretary of Labor. We did a show on Mr. Puzder about, 2 weeks ago. Now, the job of the Secretary of Labor is to protect labor. At one time, it was the Department of Commerce and Labor, but in around 1913, they split it up. They realized that commerce and labor had competing interests, and it might be in the best interests of our working people to have their own cabinet department. Of course, this was at the height of the progressive movement. It actually had progressives in the Senate. So Andrew Puzder is the chief executive of CKE Restaurants. As my listeners know, Puzder runs CKE. They own Carl's Jr., Hardee's, Green Burrito, and Red Burrito. And as I've talked about on the show before, Mr. Puzder has a history of being against labor, being against the minimum wage, being against family leave, against overtime, against Obamacare. And we had Robin Yurovic from Capital in Maine. She's an investigative reporter on the show. She said that when it comes to sexual harassment cases, CKE leads the fast food industry in sexual harassment lawsuits and consent decrees from the Justice Department. They really do not protect women at CKE restaurants. I recommend that you go back and listen to that interview with Robin Yurovic from Capital in Maine. Donald Trump has nominated Andrew Puzder, who is no friend to labor and no friend to women. Robin Yurovic wrote a piece for Newsweek and Capital in Maine. And when he was running CKE Industries, his company was hit with race discrimination and sexual harassment lawsuits. According to Robin Jurevic, she writes in Capital Maine, our investigation has found that since Puzder became CEO of CKE in 2000, Carl's Jr. and Hardee's have been hit with more federal employment discrimination lawsuits than any other major U.S. hamburger chain. She goes on to write, as a defendant in such cases, it is number one among burger chains with $1 billion or more in annual sales. This is not a man who's friendly to women. I have an article first published in the Riverfront Times, July 26, 1989. In another life, Andrew Puzder, before he became the CEO of CKE Industries, he was a St. Louis attorney who wrote Missouri's anti-abortion law, was named in the late 1980s in Missouri to head the Task Force for Mothers and Unborn Children. He was named by then-Governor John Ashcroft. You might remember John Ashcroft as the first Attorney General under George W. Bush. Very religious man. He ran for Senate in 2000 in Missouri and lost to a dead person. I believe he's the only person in the history of the Senate to lose his seat to a dead person. This is true. But since he was such a loyal Republican, George W. Bush made him his first Attorney General. Very religious man, John Ashcroft. Very religious. Before he took the oath of office as Attorney General, his father rubbed Crisco oil on his forehead to recreate the rites of the high priests of the First Temple. This is a very serious Christian. So Christian, he behaves like a Jew. This is serious stuff. A lot of things wrong with John Ashcroft, but one heroic moment, there was an element of heroism. While he was Attorney General, the National Security Agency under President Bush and Dick Cheney created Stellar Wind. It was a code name for information collected through the president's new surveillance program authorized by the National Security Agency. They were tapping our phones and opening our mail. And the Justice Department ruled that Stellar Wind, John Ashcroft ruled that Stellar Wind was illegal. Then he came down with acute pancreatitis. So he was in the hospital, and President Bush sent his chief of staff, Andrew Card, and White House counsel, Alberto Gonzalez, to Ashcroft in the hospital with a pen in hand and insisted that he reverse the Justice Department's decision canceling Stellar Wind. Ashcroft's wife was by his side, and she was horrified. She made a call. Acting Attorney General at the time was James Comey. He went to Ashcroft's bedside and told Andrew Card and Alberto Gonzalez to leave, that Ashcroft is not going to reverse his Justice Department's ruling that Stellar Wind is illegal. Comey said, I'm the acting Attorney General, and I'm not going to sign it. And the current Attorney General over there on the hospital bed is also not going to sign it. It wasn't signed as a reward. George W. Bush rewarded Alberto Gonzalez with Ashcroft's job when he resigned. And Comey was considered one of the good guys in the Bush administration. He stood up to Cheney, Andrew Card, and refused to authorize Stellar Wind. So he was named FBI chief by President Obama because he was somebody we could trust up until about 10 days before the election. Back to Ashcroft. Very religious guy. At the time, he was the governor of Missouri, good friends with the St. Louis attorney, Andrew Puzder, who is now Trump's pick to be Secretary of Labor. And at that time, Andrew Puzder was the anti-abortion warrior, family values. Well, around that time, his 1986 divorce depositions became public. His wife accused him of some serious abuse that required the police to come out. there were definitely pictures of Mrs. Puzder, no longer his wife. There were pictures taken by the police of Lisa Puzder, black and blue. From the Riverfront Times in Missouri, it says that items that are in the public record that are not sealed, the former Mrs. Puzder alleged that Andrew Puzder hit her, threw her to the kitchen floor. When she tried to call the police for help in 1986, he unplugged the phone. After that, she sought a protective order against Puzder, alleging that he choked her, threw her to the floor, hit her in the head, pushed his knee into her chest, twisted her arm, threw her against the wall, dragged her across the floor, wouldn't let her call 911, and then kicked her in the back. There was a mutual consent order that prohibited Puzder from entering the second and third floors of their home. Puzder did acknowledge in the deposition that in the late 70s, he and his wife got into a shouting match that caused neighbors to phone the police. The police showed up and found Puzder and his wife throwing plates at each other because Andrew Puzder was yelling at his wife over the way she cleaned the house. Puzder said in the divorce deposition, yes, the police did show up. Yes, we were throwing plates, but not at each other. And the neighbors did call the police. There was another allegation that Andrew Puzder, Donald Trump's choice for Secretary of Labor, Puzder and his wife were in a car coming home from dinner in 1985, and Puzder, according to his wife, punched her. He said he recalls no incident, but he added, I do recall coming back from a restaurant, and both my wife and I had liquid refreshment at dinner. So he was drinking and driving, according to the deposition. The couple was married in 73, divorced in 1987. They have two children. Puzder, when he was being considered for, at that time, Governor Ashcroft's Task Force for Mothers and Unborn Children, as a pro-life champion, he told the Riverfront Times that his domestic troubles should have no bearing on his public work. Quote, this is a personal matter and has nothing to do with issues that I'm speaking out on. It's a personal matter. Kind of like abortion. His wife, like Ivana Trump, later recanted all these accusations, even though her lawyer at the time, Daniel Sokol, who later became vice chairman of the family law section of the Missouri Bar Association, take that information for what it's worth. Sokol says he has copies of medical reports that would back up the claims that Puzder hit his wife. He said he was unable to talk Puzder's wife into going to trial on a claim of adult abuse because Mrs. Puzder knew that her husband was an attorney and kind of understood that he could withstand the rigors of litigation better. That's Andrew Puzder, very active in Lawyers for Life. It's an anti-abortion group in Missouri. He wrote Missouri House Bill 1596 that the Supreme Court upheld, which made it harder for women to get abortions. So that's Andrew Puzder. Donald Trump wants him to be Secretary of Labor. Nice, right? Of course, she recanted the same way Ivana does, the same way most women do, because they've got kids and they want money. They want a settlement. They just want this guy to go away. Bad guy. It makes sense that a guy who throws plates at his wife and screams at her about her house cleaning would treat his employees at Carl's Jr. even worse because they're not blood. They're not his wife. Abusive bully. I've been complaining about Bill Kristol. Speaking of abusive bullies, Bill Kristol has been tweeting up a storm against Donald Trump, expiating his sins for the war in Iraq by being against Donald Trump. A lot of people are doing that now. You know, I'm optimistic. People from the right wing are going after Donald Trump. John Yoo wrote an op-ed piece in the New York Times on Monday wringing his hands over Donald Trump's executive order banning Muslims. John Yoo, if you probably don't remember, was the counsel to George W. Bush, who wrote letters in the White House telling George W. Bush that torture was okay, that waterboarding was okay. But now John Yoo, like Bill Kristol, is saying, where did Donald Trump come from? This man is horrible. We must stop him. John Yoo, a Bush appointee, he now teaches at Berkeley of all places, we do have to destroy Donald Trump and Steve Bannon. And we do need allies. But when I see people like John Yoo and Bill Kristol attacking Trump, I know that the real reason they're attacking Trump is because Donald Trump has made it settled law that the Bush administration was a total disaster. If you remember in the debates, he humiliated Jeb Bush. He touched the third rail of Republican politics. 9/11 happened on your brother's watch. Your brother did not keep us safe. And then during the debates, he touched the fourth rail, and he said, Iraq did not attack us on 9/11. You don't do that if you're a Republican. And then he touched the fifth rail, and he said, Iraq was a disaster. Trump said that he was against invading Iraq, which it turns out he was lying about that. But he's made it settled law, Trump has, that the invasion of Iraq was pretty much a crime. And that is why John Yoo and Bill Kristol are going after Trump, because they can't control him. Is Trump dangerous? Yes. Is Bannon dangerous? Yes. But be very wary of the neoconservatives who are attacking Trump. They're not worried about our freedoms. They're worried about their reputations. To wit, Elliot Cohn. He is the director right now of strategic studies at Johns Hopkins University. From 2007 to 2009, he was Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice's counselor. Before that, he worked for Paul Wolfowitz, who was one of Donald Rumsfeld's stooges during the Iraq invasion, over at defense. Elliot Cohn, along with Bill Kristol, invented the invasion of Iraq. He co-founded PNAC, the Project for the New American Century, PNAC. It was back in 1997, and it was a bipartisan organization out of Washington, D.C., that pushed for an invasion of Saddam Hussein's Iraq. Topple Saddam Hussein in Iraq, create an Iraq of democracy, and it will spread like wildfire throughout the Middle East. That was PNAC, the Project for the New American Century. They had a war plan all in place right after 9/11. Benjamin Netanyahu belonged to PNAC. Rumsfeld belonged to it. It was created by Bill Kristol and this guy Elliot Cohn. When we needed to go to war with Iraq, even though they didn't attack us on 9/11, there was Elliot Cohn working as Dick Cheney's propaganda parrot, going on every talk show saying that Mohammed Atta, one of the ringleaders of the 9/11 hijacking, had met in Czechoslovakia with an Iraqi intelligence officer, proving that Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11. This is a libel that continues to be spread in the Weekly Standard, the magazine that Bill Kristol founded, which continues to be published, even though it doesn't make any money. It's subsidized by people like Rupert Murdoch. Guys like Bill Kristol will talk about the moral hazard of welfare. People should be able to take care of themselves, even though he has been living off rich benefactors for decades. The Weekly Standard could not survive without rich benefactors paying the bills. There's no market for the Weekly Standard. He is being paid by people like the Koch brothers and Rupert Murdoch to write things that will make them happy. So Elliot Cohn also was against President Obama's decision to put Chuck Hagel, a Republican, in defense because Elliot Cohen didn't believe that Chuck Hagel would want to invade Iran. You see, Elliot Cohen has a new book out, and he's still pushing PNAC. He has a new book out. It's called The Big Stick, The Limits of Soft Power and the Necessity of Military Force. The necessity of military force. So he's out there pushing for more invasions. Steve Bannon just put Iran on notice this week, right? Iran launched a ballistic missile. President Bannon and Trump told them there's a new sheriff in town. Donald Trump wants to get rid of the deal that Obama struck with Iran. Trump is rattling his saber and saying, you know, we need to go into Iran. So you would think Elliot Cohen would be glad that Steve Bannon is president. And yet, Elliot Cohen, just like Bill Kristol, created the invasion of Iraq. Just like Bill Kristol, Elliot Cohen is upset with Donald Trump and calls him a mortal threat to our republic. He writes in The Atlantic. And by the way, The Atlantic has a great website, which I recommend that you go to every day. The Atlantic Monthly, it's a magazine, but they've really mastered the internet. Very readable website that they update every day. This is what Elliot Cohen wrote about Donald Trump. The problem with Donald Trump, precisely, is one of temperament and character. You know who had character and temperament? George W. Bush. Very disciplined, jogged, very polite, and could be manipulated and controlled and talked into invading Iraq. This is what Elliot Cohen writes. It will not get better. It will get worse as power intoxicates Trump and those around him. It will probably end in calamity, substantial domestic protests and violence, a breakdown of international economic relationships, the collapse of major alliances, or perhaps one or more new wars, even with China, on top of the ones we already have. It will not be surprising in the slightest if his term ends not in 4 or in 8 years, but sooner, with impeachment or removal under the 25th Amendment. The sooner Americans get used to these likelihoods, the better. This is from Elliot Cohen, who gave us the war in Iraq. Why is he still talking? This is a man who has a new book out called The Big Stick, The Limits of Soft Power and the Necessity of Military Force. He's saying we need to flex our military muscle around the world. And yet he writes that Trump is going to get us into a war. Well, yeah, so is Elliot Cohen. In fact, you already got us into a war. You got us into Iraq. 2 million dead Iraqis. 4 million refugees uprooted in Iraq. The biggest military blunder in the history of the United States. Elliot Cohen and Bill Kristol created this. They created, and John Yoo broke the Geneva Conventions by writing memos authorizing waterboarding and torture. And all three of them are writing pieces in the New York Times and Atlantic Monthly. Oh, Donald Trump, he's destroying our Constitution. My advice to everybody is to calm down. If Bill Kristol and Elliot Cohen were wrong about Iraq and they're against Donald Trump, why would we think they'd be right about Trump? It gives me hope. It gives me hope when I see these craven, self-serving lunatics like Bill Kristol, John Yoo, and Elliot Cohen attacking Trump. They have been wrong about everything. Makes me think they're going to be wrong about Trump. They loathe Trump because Trump broke their brand. During the debates, he made it established law that neocons like Elliot Cohen and Bill Kristol were morally and intellectually bankrupt. That's why they're against Trump. Well, Mr. Trump gave an interview with Bill O'Reilly during the Super Bowl, and they talked about Mr. Putin, and Trump said, I respect him. I respect a lot of people. But that doesn't mean I'll get along with them. O'Reilly pushed and he said to the president, Putin is a killer. Trump didn't blink. He said, there are a lot of killers. We have a lot of killers. What, you think our country is so innocent? Let me repeat what Trump said. There are a lot of killers. We have a lot of killers. You think our country is so innocent? Now, Trump has to go. He has to be impeached. He has to resign. But he says things that are true. He says a lot of true things. That's why Bill Kristol, George W. Bush, Brent Scowcroft, that's why the Republicans don't like him. I'm not defending Trump, but he says, you think our country is so innocent? There's a new book out by Joshua Kurlansik. It's called A Great Place to Have a War, America and Laos and the Birth of a Military CIA. I'm going to try to get him on the show. I've been reading reviews of it, and I was shocked by what I didn't know about Laos or Laos. At the time, there was a secret war in Laos, in Laos. But I'm going to call it Laos. There was a secret war in Laos, Indochina. During the 50s, the French evacuated Indochina, Vietnam, and Laos is next door. America slowly entered the war in Vietnam. Under Kennedy, we discovered that the North Vietnamese had something called the Ho Chi Minh Trail and were using Laos to run arms and run soldiers in and out of South Vietnam to attack our side. So we began bombing Laos. A conventional war was out of the question. We were barely able to start a conventional war against North Vietnam. So we had to have a secret war against the Pathet Lao. They were the communists. So Operation Momentum began in 1961. It was started by the CIA. They used the Air Force. They used the Air Force, but it was the first time that the CIA created their own paramilitary unit. This is all according to Joshua Kurlansik's new book, A Great Place to Have a War, America and Laos and the Birth of a Military CIA. Last September, President Obama visited, I don't know how to pronounce this, Vientiane, the capital of Laos. And President Obama openly admitted that the United States, between 1963 and 1974, dropped 2 million tons of bombs on Laos. If you were to take all the bombs dropped on Germany and Japan, all the bombs dropped on Germany and Japan combined during World War II, more bombs were dropped on Laos between 1963 and 1974 than all the bombs dropped on Germany and Japan. Laos, according to President Obama, is the most heavily bombed nation in history. Did you know that? I didn't know that until President Obama said that back in September. And then I conveniently forgot it because I liked Obama and I was happy with my country and I was optimistic and I didn't want to relitigate the past. But we fought a secret war for a decade and a half in Laos. American bombs through the CIA killed 10% of the Laotian people. 80% of all bombing casualties were civilians. I believe that's called a war crime. I believe that constitutes a trial at The Hague. Operation Momentum, which I'm just learning about because I'm reading about this book, A Great Place to Have a War, America and Laos and the Birth of a Military CIA by Joshua Kurlansik. For more than a decade, every 8 minutes, around the clock, 24 hours, 7 days a week, we were dropping bombs on Laos. It cost $500 million a year, which is the equivalent to about $3.5 billion today. So who profits? Why were we doing this? why are we bombing Laos? This is a country about the size of Ohio. Why are we bombing them? A couple of $1 billion a year? That's a lot of money for bomb makers. And they weren't just ordinary bombs. We dropped 260 million cluster bombs over a course of 580,000 bombing missions. Think about this. 580,000 bombing missions between 1964 and 1973 over Laos. Every 8 minutes, 24 hours a day for 9 years, according to Legacy of War. This is a website that's trying to raise money to remove the unexploded ordnance that's still there in Laos. I'll get to that in a second. According to Legacy of War, we dropped 7 bombs for every man, woman, and child living in Laos. Half of Laos is now contaminated with UXOs. That stands for unexploded ordnances. Those would be bombs, grenades, and landmines. And cluster bombs. Now, what is a cluster bomb? It's a bomb that contains smaller sub-bombs, mini-bombs. So when it drops, hundreds of little bombs spread out. They scatter about 100 yards away from the crater. 260 million cluster bombs dropped by the United States. 30% of them didn't detonate. Paying a lot of money for these bombs. Shouldn't we get our money back from the people who made them? 30% of them fail to detonate. Each bomb contains about 600 to 700 small bomblets. Right now, there are about 78 million unexploded bomblets throughout Laos, in their rice fields, in their villages, on their school grounds, roads. The bombing stopped in 1973. Since then, 34,000 Laotians have either been killed or injured by stepping on these cluster bombs that go off. 60% of the victims are children. And even though President Obama in September promised to dedicate money to get rid of the unexploded ordnances, at this time, according to Legacy of War, only 1% of those bombs have been removed. When Donald Trump talks about Putin and tells Bill O'Reilly, yeah, he's a killer. America has a lot of killers. Trump said, you think our country is so innocent? We kind of destroyed Laos. 1 million Laotians were turned into refugees in their own country. We knew about it. Senator Fulbright was the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee. This all was exposed in the New York Times. Was exposed on CBS News. It was exposed in the early 70s by Senator Fulbright. It didn't stop for another 2 or 3 years after we learned about our secret war in Laos. Is the CIA ashamed of this? No. According to the author of A Great Place to Have a War, Joshua Kurlansik, the CIA considers it a sacred war, a good war, because it proved that the CIA could go from being an intelligence-gathering organization to a paramilitary force. The CIA thinks very fondly of a secret war that they conducted in Laos, where they lied to Congress and denied and kept it secret. By the way, they lost. The CIA lost the war. The Pathet Lao, the communists, took over, and they're still in power. But the CIA considers it a sacred war because they proved to themselves that they were able to fight a war with immunity. The war was a success because they were able to do it, because they were able to keep it secret, because they were able to launch secret wars in Central America, because 10 years later, when we discovered what Bill Casey and Oliver North were doing in Nicaragua, our law enforcement, our senators, looked into that abyss and the CIA, and they blinked, and they said, you know what? We better not go there. You know, the CIA had bin Laden in 2001. They had him in their crosshairs. George Tenet talks about this. He was the head of the CIA. He said they had him in Kandahar in 2001. But Rumsfeld, the Secretary of Defense, made the CIA stand down because Rumsfeld wanted the Defense Department to get the kill. Within our government, there are little power bases and everybody's fighting for their own share of the power. The CIA is fighting among itself. The Pentagon has its own intelligence agency, and they're fighting with the CIA. This is way beyond anything you and I understand. But when Trump, who's got to be removed, takes on the CIA, it's not like they're innocent. And don't flatter yourself, America. It's not like you're innocent. It's not like I am innocent. It's not like we woke up one day and there was a coup d'etat and Donald Trump seized power and suddenly evil was emanating from the Oval Office. This has been going on for decades. We chose not to pay attention. And we're going to continue not to pay attention to most of this stuff after they get rid of Trump. Trump is the boogeyman. Trump is scary. He's not subtle. He's a wrecking ball. He speaks the truth, even though he's an inveterate liar. He speaks the truth about the CIA. He speaks the truth about Iraq. He speaks the truth about the Bush family and what we've done, that we are a nation of sinners by looking the other way. We are a nation of killers. So stop flattering yourself. We're not an innocent people. That doesn't mean we can't get better, but we've committed a lot of horrible crimes that we knew about. We knew about Laos. I knew about this, sort of. I chose not to pay attention to it. It didn't start with Trump, and it's not going to end with Trump. Constant vigilance. Constant vigilance. These are bad people. And we've always had bad people. We're a military nation. We spend more on military than we do on schools or feeding our children. It's not going to change overnight. But let Trump be the wake-up call. And let's slowly get better. But don't flatter yourself, America. We didn't suddenly become bad when Trump took over. We've conveniently either forgotten what we've done or have chosen not to pay attention. Start paying attention. David Dayen writes for The Intercept and The Nation magazine, two of my favorite publications. He is the author of Chain of Title, How Three Ordinary Americans Uncovered Wall Street's Great Foreclosure Fraud. It won the Studs and Ida Turkle Prize. And you also write for Weiss and The American Prospect. One of your stories is about Friday's executive order in which Donald Trump promised to overturn many of the regulations in Dodd-Frank, and you call it a full frontal assault on financial reform. What is Dodd-Frank?
So Dodd-Frank was the response to the financial crisis. In 2010, Democrats held Congress, and they passed this very sweeping set of new regulations. It's so massive you can barely explain it or define it in any cogent way. But it was a number of reforms, some of them sort of responding to what happened. There's some, you know, loan reforms, some reforms of derivatives trading, which was one of the main drivers of the crisis. And then others were just sort of sets of things that Democrats and reformers and liberals have wanted to do on financial reform for some time. So it's like an over 1,000-page set of rules, hundreds of rules that were then passed on to the regulatory agencies to then write based on the guidelines in Dodd-Frank. So it was one of the larger accomplishments, I think people will say, of the Obama era.
So when you say it was sent on to the agencies, it was sent to the SEC to deal with stocks, and the FDIC to deal with banks, and then with the Federal Reserve, they created the Consumer Protection Bureau with...
Right, that's the one new agency. I mean, a lot of what Dodd-Frank did was kind of tweak around the edges, take the system that we already have, and just sort of, you know, add some more supervision here, add some more... certain types of data gathering or disclosures there. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau is the only new agency that was created out of the ashes of the financial crisis.
And this is where we first heard of Elizabeth Warren. She was the...
That's right. It was her brainchild, actually. She wrote in a magazine years before that we should have an agency for defective financial products the way that we have an agency for defective toasters, you know, the Consumer Product Safety Commission. So the idea was to, you know, take that concept of an agency looking out for consumers and apply it to the most important purchases of our lives, which are these financial purchases, whether it's loans for housing or auto loans or student loans or whatever, that there would be an agency that would be centrally located and be the only agency where consumers come first.
And they, when you say consumers, the people who buy stocks, who go to financial planners, those are the consumers we're talking about.
Right. I mean, not necessarily stocks, but yes, people who purchase financial products, whether it's mortgages or auto loans or things of that nature,
and it would be housed in the Federal Reserve to keep it apolitical. That was the idea.
Yes, that's generally the idea. I mean, really, the idea is the funding would be independent of the appropriations process, and if that's the case, then when Republicans get in power, or really, you know, anyone with an axe to grind against the agency gets in power, they can't defund it through the regulatory process, which happens, by the way, on many of the other banking agencies. And it's sort of a way that Congress can keep these agencies under their thumb. The Commodities Futures Trading Commission, which is the agency that handles this derivatives market, which is multi-trillions of dollars of trading that happens on a daily basis, is a woefully unfunded agency that can barely keep up with the trades that are being done themselves, let alone police misconduct with regards to those trades. So this is a clever way for Congress to really keep their attentions on these types of agencies by essentially defunding them. And so the idea with the CFPB was that...
CFPB is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau.
That's correct. And we'll keep it out of the hands of the appropriators by having it independently funded through the Federal Reserve.
And the Republicans hated Elizabeth Warren. Obama couldn't name her to this post. A guy named Cordray was replaced. Cordray was put in instead of her, and she went on to become one of my favorite senators.
Good idea, keeping her out of Washington.
Yeah.
By the Republicans. Slick move.
So people don't remember the financial disaster. Americans were sold bogus products by Merrill Lynch, by Bear Stearns, by Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs was revealed to be selling financial instruments to one client and betting against it with another client.
That's right.
And they talk about privatizing Medicare and Social Security. They say, you know, Americans are smart enough to invest their own money. They should be smart enough they can invest their money better than Social Security can. And yet there are vultures out there on Wall Street who are supposed to give good advice so you can invest your IRA or your health savings account properly.
Right.
And there was a fiduciary rule that...
Right. And that actually is unrelated to Dodd-Frank. The fiduciary rule, as you described it, I call it the conflict of interest rule. It requires, and it comes out of the Department of Labor, because this is about the retirement plans you get at work. So your 401k plan, your pension plan, those types of retirement accounts. Now, you commonly have a, if you're in a 401k, you have a plan sponsor, somebody, some company, some financial institution is running that plan, and you can get advice from them on what to choose. Now, you make your own decision, but you get, financial advice from an expert on what makes sense for your financial future. And currently, those sponsors, those investment advisors, whether they're from, the plan sponsor in your workplace or a separate outside advisor that you go to for help, they operate under what is called a suitability standard. And a suitability standard means that they are only required to come up with recommendations for you that are, quote-unquote, suitable for you. And that word means essentially nothing. It's a very vague term. It doesn't have any sort of force of law. It means that these advisors can recommend products that they get paid to sell you. They can steer you into things that may not be suitable for you at all, that may cost more than equivalent products, that may be riskier than other alternatives, but they get paid for it by whoever's peddling this. And they're allowed to place you into those. Now, under a fiduciary standard, which is what the Department of Labor came up with as a new rule. They haven't updated these rules since what is known as ERISA, I don't remember what it stands for, the Employee Retirement Income Securities Act, I believe, in the 1970s. This is the last time they updated this portion of the law. And under a fiduciary standard, your investment advisor would be required to act in your best interest. That is literally not the law right now. They can operate and recommend products to you that are not in your best interest. But under this fiduciary rule, they would be forced to. Now, the Obama administration tried for years and years to put this thing together. There's a lady at the Department of Labor who's like a force of nature named Phyllis Borzi, and if it wasn't for her, this wouldn't have ever existed at all. Because the Obama administration, was getting a lot of flack from investment advisors. They put out a report in 2015 that showed that individual investors lose $17 billion a year because of these conflict of interest, because investment advisors place them in plans that have high fees, that are undisclosed, that are costlier than equivalent products. So $17 billion a year essentially being taken out of your pocket as a retail investor and put into the pockets of these Wall Street and financial institution players.
Which is
the fiduciary rule was passed in April of last year. And it was finalized. The implementation date was April of this year, so just a couple months from now. And what was done last Friday is that Donald Trump signed an order, and all the order says is that the Department of Labor is required to review the rule. But we know what really wants to be done. The one of his top advisors is a guy, Gary Cohn, who used to be the president of Goldman Sachs. He's a lifer from Goldman Sachs. And he out and out said, even though this is supposed to be just a review and in sort of without putting your thumb on the scale, he out and out said this is a bad rule for consumers. And what he said was that it's like if you have a menu and you're required to put all kinds of healthy food on it, and they don't let you put the unhealthy food on, even though it might taste good because it'll kill you someday. That was his justification for killing the fiduciary rule and allowing people to put poison, I guess, in your investment account.
So has it been killed? Where does it stand?
Right. So, as I said, the implementation date isn't until April, which means that at the conclusion of this review, they can simply delay or stop the implementation of the rule. There's a long process that any kind of administrative rulemaking at the federal agency level takes a long time to do. You have to do a proposed rule, then a public comment process, even to rescind a rule. You have to go through all these steps. It could take a year or more. However, if it never gets implemented, effectively it's dead, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's
like Merrick Garland. It's Merrick Garland.
That's correct. Yeah, I mean, it's theoretical at that point. And if they're determined and they halt the implementation process, then I would imagine it doesn't come into play. Now, one thing I can say, and some people have said, is that a lot of companies have already set in motion the idea of becoming fiduciaries. A lot of these investment advisory companies have already pushed forward, done a lot of the planning, and plan to go ahead and act as fiduciary. So you will have some players in this industry decide, okay, you know what? We might actually get more business if we advertise that we're not here to screw you as the client, that we're acting in your best interest. So, you know, in some sense, putting the rule together might have helped the state of the industry to some degree. However, if honest companies have to compete against dishonest companies, and dishonest companies can make lots and lots of money off their clients by essentially hiding the ball and not disclosing these additional risks and these additional costs, it's hard for the honest company to really compete over time because they're simply at a disadvantage because they can't make money in the same way. So even though there's a trend in the industry to move towards being fiduciaries, I still think that not having a rule is going to be very detrimental, and it's going to cost people a lot of money that they can, you know, hang on to in retirement.
So my listeners who have money, why are they listening to this show? That's my first
question.
Secondly, well, who do you, can you go to somebody to get advice? Can you, even without the fiduciary rule, can you ask an advisor, do you stand to make money off this advice?
You not only can, but you should. I mean, any investment advisor that you go to, you should ask them, are you willing to operate as a fiduciary in this relationship that I'm setting up with you? And will you put that in writing?
And what does that mean? Excuse me for one second.
Things.
David, what is so when you say, will you act as a fiduciary, what does that What does that
mean? It essentially is shorthand for saying, will you act in my best interest? Will you commit in writing, in a contract, to acting in my best interest, to disclosing all conflicts of interest you might have, to offering me products that are suitable for me, things like that. So there's a contractual kind of requirement when you say I'm acting as a fiduciary that opens you up to a lawsuit, essentially, if you are found to not have acted in your client's best interest.
So okay, I didn't know what a fiduciary meant. I've called a lot of stockbrokers douches, but I've never called them fiduciaries. So
yeah, when you put the FI in front, it changes the meaning a little bit.
Dodd-Frank Section 1504. It's an anti-corruption rule that you write about in The Nation, and the Senate rescinded it on Friday, I believe. Is that a gift to Rex Spillerson, the former CEO of ExxonMobil, now our Secretary of State?
It really is, because Rex Tillerson actually personally lobbied against this rule getting put into Dodd-Frank. As I mentioned before, Dodd-Frank is kind of this grab bag of different ideas that have been floating around. And one of them was that the SEC should force oil and gas companies to disclose any payments that they make to foreign governments in order to get entry and access to their resources. And it's a pure anti-corruption rule so that investors can see what is being done in terms of getting into various countries. These payments can be used to sort of hide certain monies. It could be illicit payments. It could be things that get laundered. There are a lot of ways that you can use these types of payments if they're undisclosed. Any undisclosed payment can be used to move money from one place to another without the authorities knowing about it. And so this is a standard that is in 30 other resource extraction countries. The idea that the Republicans put forward in killing this rule was that this makes an unlevel playing field for the United States, but that's not true. I mean, most countries that have oil and gas industries have this kind of disclosure framework set up. And now we're one of the few that doesn't. We're now the anomaly because this rule didn't get finalized until very late in the Obama administration. And under a very little known statute called the Congressional Review Act, Congress has the right within a 60-day time frame to review any regulations that get finalized. And they could do what is called a resolution of disapproval. And it only takes 50 votes in the Senate and 218 in the House. It only takes a majority vote. You can't filibuster these resolutions. And if they're signed by the president, then those rules get rescinded and no rule similar to them can ever be brought up without congressional approval. And this rule very rarely comes into play because, well, it's a simple reason that presidents don't usually vote, sign bills that rescind their own rules. However, when you have a change of power and you have the party in Congress, running Congress as the same party as the new president, you can get situations like this. The only other time that the Congressional Review Act has been used was George W. Bush. When he came in, they rescinded a workplace ergonomics rule from 2001.
Right.
That was the only other time this happened. So, it's because it only takes this majority vote, it's a very attractive option to kick off this, bonanza of deregulation that we're about to see. And so the Senate took it, the Senate and the House, They actually killed another one called the stream protection rule that I think that's it was a requirement that waste from coal mining not be pushed into streams, which seems sensible enough, but that had to go too. So the first two rules under the Congressional Review Act that were killed benefit oil, gas, and coal interests.
It's just I want to get, before you go, I want to get to your article in The Intercept. Stephen Schwarzman is the head of Donald Trump's White House jobs panel. So
right.
Stephen Schwarzman, who is Stephen Schwarzman, and he's in charge of creating jobs?
Stephen Schwarzman is the CEO of a company called Blackstone, and Blackstone is a private equity firm. And what is a private equity firm? Well, private equity firms are these investment companies that pool together millions and millions of dollars, and they go out and they purchase companies. And they usually load up these companies with a lot of debt. They used to be called leverage buyout companies. And they load them up. They try to change the management system within the company. Often what they do is they just extract a lot of value. Sometimes they sell the real estate off, or they cut costs to the bone, use financial engineering to take money out of that company, and they spin it around, and within 3 to 5 years they put that company back. Either they sell it or they do an IPO and put it, take it public. And they're trying to make money off of these different companies.
And they do it by firing everybody.
Often, by firing people, by using the bankruptcy provisions, by restructuring union contracts. There are a variety of ways that private equity firms make their money. This is, Mitt Romney was a private equity fund manager at Bain Capital. This is this type of vulture capitalism that we've seen more and more, actually. And private equity has a problem. The problem is that about a quarter of all private equity funds come from pensions. Whether it's public pension funds, union pension funds, private companies pension funds, those institutional investors put a lot of money into private equity because then they get returns.
Can I slow you down? You've been very generous with your time, and I just want to make sure I understand the terminology. Blackstone is a private equity company. So what they'll do is they'll raise billions of dollars,
right?
And they'll take in equity, and they'll buy a publicly traded company. In other words, they'll take
sometimes public, sometimes private, but yes, they'll buy a company. They'll buy a company and they'll take it private,
which means it's no longer traded as a stock.
That's right. That's right. Or it might not have ever been, and they'll just buy a private company.
And then they go in and they slash and they burn. They get rid
right.
of. They make short-term decisions for quick
that's
bucks.
Correct.
They're not thinking.
They hollow it out, and they extract as much value out of these companies as they can, and then they spin them back out within 3 to 5 years.
That's what Gordon Gekko in Wall
sure.
Street was
mm-hmm.
doing that to Bud's father's airline.
Right. And Blackstone, by the way, is the largest private equity company in the world.
And that's run by Stephen Schwarzman.
This is Stephen Schwarzman. It's the number one company that does this stuff.
So a pension plan, if you're with the Teamsters or if you're
right.
a member of the Writers Guild Union, you have a pension that builds up over time, and when you retire, you draw from it. They have to invest that pension and get returns on it, and there's a
sure.
lot of money with these unions, the teachers' unions, CalPERS, the big California
right.
pension for public employees.
Public employees.
And they have to invest that money, and they have to get a good return on it. So they
right.
they go to Stephen Schwarzman and say, here are a couple of billion dollars, invest
right.
it.
That's right. And the problem for the likes of Stephen Schwarzman is that there just aren't a lot of pensions like that anymore. What are called defined benefit pensions. You know, it's still a significant sum of money, but that money is diminishing. And the real money is over in what are called defined contribution pensions, and that's your 401k.
All right, so let's this is okay.
I know, so, it's complicated, so,
so
we'll slow down.
Our fathers and grandfathers who worked for factories had defined benefits.
Right.
So, in other words, when they retired, they would
get a set sum of money every month, came in the mail, that was your paycheck, that was one leg of your retirement stool. You had your Social Security, you had your savings, and you had your defined benefit pension. You knew every month you were going to get that check from your company in the mail that you paid for, you paid into all your working life.
And it's administered, and it's administered by a company that you used to.
By the company, that's right.
Then under the Reagan administration, there were a lot of mergers and acquisitions, and a lot of companies that had been around for 30, 40, 50 years disappeared or got bought out. Mm-hmm. But they had to still hold on to these pensions and these pay out these defined benefits.
Right.
And it became a burden for these companies. It made it more difficult to engage in mergers and acquisitions because you had underfunded pensions. Sometimes you had overfunded pensions, which made you attractive to Gordon Gekko. But for the most part, they wanted these pensions, these defined benefit plans off the books to create more fluidity.
And as I understand it, in the 1970s, sort of accidentally, this part of the tax code was created where companies could, instead of a defined benefit, they could just pay in an employer match to an individual retirement plan and then let the individual choose the various stocks or mutual funds that they want to invest in. And they would not have to do this defined benefit over time, but they would just have to set up this plan through the tax code. That's why it's called a 401k. That's a section of the tax code. And just let the individual take control of that plan. Now, that's very popular.
Okay, and that's a defined contribution. So, in other words,
right. The only thing you have to do as a company is contribute your match to that 401k plan, and that's the end of your involvement.
And the employee then it falls on the employee to invest that money properly.
That's right. That's right. And this is much cheaper, needless to say, for the company. So you saw a wave of these 401k plans replacing defined benefit pensions. And defined benefit pensions are a fairly small sliver of the country of workers actually have these now. So defined contributions are sort of the way to go. The problem is, it's only a problem for private equity, but the problem for private equity is that they are not in that market. They are not involved in 401k plans, and it's for a good reason. Number one, private equity funds usually require that their investors are locked in for 3 to 5 years in their plan. And the way that 401ks are set up, you could buy and sell a stock or a mutual fund any day of the week. There's no locking mechanism for a 401k. So that's number one. Number two is that private equity funds usually require a very large stake, like in the millions of dollars, from their investors before they let them into a fund. And 401k investors, obviously, at the individual level, don't have that kind of scratch. So for those reasons, you've never been able to buy into a private equity fund in your 401k. But because the entire retirement landscape is changing, private equity wants to change that. And that brings us back to this fiduciary rule. So as I mentioned, private equity wants to get into this 401k market. They think the best way they can do it is if they go through plan sponsors, you know, somebody at your employer. Usually it's an outside company that's hired by your employer who puts together what types of what offerings you have available to you in your 401k. So TIAA, CREF, or one of these companies, financial companies, says, okay, you can buy this, this, or this. You can buy these mutual funds, or you can buy this, what they call a target date fund. If you're, you might have heard that. If you're, if you have a 401k, it's supposed to be this fund that will get you to retirement, and it will change the mix of the stocks and mutual funds in the product over time, so that when you are getting older, it's when you're younger, it's more aggressive. When you're older, it's more conservative, and it gets you to it's supposed to get you to a target number of that an amount of money that you will be able to, you know, retire on. So private equity has decided, well, let's get into those. Let's get into those target date funds, because that's a lot of money amassed, and we can figure out with the plan sponsors how we can do it. And the individuals can buy and sell the target fund, but we'll have enough money available, and we don't want to change our system too much. Let's get into those target date funds. Now, these private equity investments are very risky. They are, there are tons of hidden fees where the managers of these private equity funds, the Mitt Romneys of the world, the Steve Schwartzmans of the world, make lots and lots of money off these, even if the investors don't. This would all have to be disclosed under the fiduciary rule. The plan sponsors would have to tell their the employees who are making the choice to pick this plan that, oh, well, we have these private equity funds in here, and they're very risky, and here are the fees, and they're all disclosed, and now you can, you know, make an informed decision. If there's no fiduciary rule, they don't have to do any of that. They can steer you into this target fund that may have these very risky investments. And by the way, you would be using your money to fund this predatory version of capitalism that's slashing worker wages and firing workers. And there's this huge pool of trillions of dollars that is suddenly available to these types of businesses to engage in that. So I think it's a twofold problem. It's not just that they're risky investments that can rip off the investors, but these investors are then going to place this money in this really, I think, negative way in which the economy works. So that's sort of the secret beneficiary of this Trump order for the fiduciary rule to kill it. Is private equity. And Stephen Schwartzman, and this who's the head of this jobs panel, was in the room with Trump the same day that he signed that order. So, and Trump said at the opening remarks at that jobs panel, we're getting rid of all your regulations, talking to the CEOs who were assembled. And he was right, because he certainly got rid of one of the more important regulations for the private equity industry to survive and thrive.
They're just looting money that they didn't earn. They look at Social Security. They see a pool of money there. They salivate right over that. They see 401ks, the money's trillions of dollars piling up. And they don't think about creating a business. They just see a pile of loot and say, how can I take that?
And 401k, I mean, the defined contribution pensions, there is $6.8 trillion invested in these defined contribution plans. So, you know, private equity looks at that and says, that's capital that we need for ourselves. We got to get in there. And they've been trying for years and years and years. And certainly killing a rule that says that advisors have to act in the best interest of their clients helps facilitate that.
Alternative facts. Wall Street operates on alternative facts. It is a, as Bernie Sanders said, an entire industry whose business model is fraud. Mm-hmm. You write in The Intercept that none of these private equity firms like Blackstone can outperform the market.
Yes, I mean, that's really the hidden story here, is that contrary to the studies that the private equity industry funds that says, oh, we get these amazing returns, we get alpha, that's the big term that they use, and alpha is supposed to stand for money above a benchmark like the Standard & Poor's 500 or the Dow. Any returns above that is called alpha. But contrary to popular belief, they actually don't beat the market most of the time, if you do an apples-to-apples comparison. So you have these investment funds, and now maybe individuals, pouring money into these alternative asset classes like private equity funds and then hedge funds, which is another very predatory industry. They do things that are a little different. They don't buy companies. They usually invest in not just companies but certain stock
and hedge funds don't outperform the market.
No, they don't either.
But they're exclusive. They have some kind of, they're like a special
right.
club, and you need to know the right person to get in there, and then this genius will invest your money.
Right. Which is true of private equity, too. I mean, they both trade off this myth that through that exclusivity, it just sounds special. It makes the investor, particularly the wealthy investor, want to be a part of it, because there's this whole mythology around these are the best managers and the best stock pickers in the whole world, and we have to be associated with them. But the truth is that lots of hedge funds and private equity firms lose their shirt,
and their clients would be much better off buying index funds.
Yeah, I mean, the truth is that you don't need any of this investment advice. Jump into a Standard & Poor's 500 index fund or a total market index fund that is completely hands-off. The fees are incredibly low, and you really don't even need any of this advice. So, you know, anytime an investment advisor is coming around and saying, have I got the idea for you, you really should just run screaming in the other direction.
To Vanguard.
Go to Vanguard, that's right.
I'm always amazing. I'm living in New York. I know you've been generous with your time, and I know you've got another deadline, but I'm living in Manhattan now, and I run into a lot of rich people, children of rich people, and there is this myth promulgated right now by Trump, his three brilliant kids, the children of the wealthy. None of them understand how money works. They always think they have to trust the greatest minds on Wall Street. And it just reinforces what I've always believed, and that is the rich are not smart. They're just lucky, especially the children of the rich. Children of the rich have no idea how money works. They are the easiest marks for these vulture capitalists. And
you might say there's one born every minute.
Yeah, the rich, when you hear of them going into hedge funds, you just go, these people are stupid.
Right.
Even the self-made rich people are stupid.
Right. And if you're a private equity titan, who and these are people who are the richest people in this world that make hundreds of millions of dollars a year, not just tens of billions. You are perpetually looking for easy marks. And if there aren't enough sons of wealthy magnates and scions, and there are diminishing investment funds that are willing to sign up with your enterprise, whether it's pension funds or endowments from universities or whatever, you need another source of money, and that's what's so dangerous about opening these up to individual retirement accounts.
Yeah, and the other interesting thing about this is there are some very intelligent rich people, but they're degenerate gamblers. So what happens is Wall Street appeals to them because it's a casino, but it's more elegant, and they are able to, through smoke and mirrors, brokers and Stephen Schwartzman are less croupiers than they are brainiacs. They present themselves as, this is not poker, this isn't the slot machine, you're smart here, you're making decisions here, there's right. research involved, you can make the right bet if you do your homework. So they have some kind of academic gravitas what is a casino, just basically a casino.
Well, yes, but the truth is that they're gamblers, but they're gamblers playing with marked cards, because the fee structure of private equity and also hedge funds is, it's commonly called 2 and 20. So they get 2% of the total investment that you make off the top. So they take 2% off the top. And then if they make any profits from you, they take 20% of those as well. So the 2% off the top is win or lose. So they're already ahead of the game. And then if they profit, they get a outsized portion of those profits. And by the way, they're doing the accounting on that. So they can exaggerate returns to make them look more robust and take more of your money. They also can set up so that, well, the investors pay for consultants, and what they do is they fire all the employees and hire them back as consultants, and then the investor has to pay the payroll rather than the private equity fund. There are all sorts of tricks and games that they play so that it's not really gambling to these private equity titans or these hedge fund managers. Because they're loading the dice
for themselves, but not their clients.
That's correct.
It's gambling.
That's
correct. It's gambling
off the clients. It's at the expense of the clients. Indeed,
it's a skim. You know, we have a casino.
Not a question.
We have a casino operator who's now our president, and Schwartzman and these hedge funds are running casinos, and they're legally skimming.
Right. And the real danger here is that we ended up with a president who's the one guy who went bankrupt in the casino business, which is almost impossible.
David Dayen is a contributor to The Intercept. He writes for Salon, The Fiscal Times, The New Republic. Your book, Chain of Title, is about three ordinary Americans uncover Wall Street's foreclosure fraud. It came out in May of 2016. Thank you for your time. You really take Byzantine, complicated financial stories and make them not only entertaining, but like a hedge fund manager, you make an idiot like me think he's smart.
Well, thank you. I appreciate those kind words.
Thank you. You'll come back real soon, I hope.
No question.
Thank you, David.
All right.
in the age of Trump? Is it possible? Is it possible for
this
us to...
This is a great topic.
It is a great topic. Can we love
I'm
one another
about it.
In a poisonous, toxic stew of hate, otherwise known as the Trump administration? Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. DavidFeldmanShow.com. Is my microphone up today?
Yes.
Okay, because I tend to whisper. I'm doing the Bing Crosby thing where I don't kill my voice. Bing Crosby, by the way, revolutionized pop music because he knew that the microphone was doing all the work, so he didn't have to scream and shout. Before Bing Crosby, everybody was...
Bing's cool.
Everybody was screaming.
I like Bing.
But he learned to whisper into the microphone, and it became very intimate. But because Bing wasn't venting enough, he had to beat his kids, because that energy
yeah,
has to go
exactly.
somewhere.
Exactly.
That energy has to go somewhere. So when you ever hear a person whispering...
They beat their kids.
They're beating Bing Crosby's kids.
His kids, yeah.
Yeah, you just, they rent themselves out. Nobody knows who Bing Crosby is.
Yes, we do. People know. People, you know who Bing Crosby is, right? Please say you do. Lance?
Oh, he's watching the clock. Okay, let me go over some stuff here before we get to the show, and I'll introduce these important guests. Love in the Age of Trump. This is a rough time. So here's what we need to do. You need to cut out the noise, declutter your life, focus on love, love yourself, take care of yourself first. I was talking to Rob Schneider, who I started it with years ago, one of the most brilliant people I know. He's so brilliant, he doesn't need to tell people how brilliant he is. Chess master, Rob Schneider. He said, love yourself, eat right. Now, I've been thinking about this. You've got to protect yourself now. It's always been dangerous times, but this is shock and awe time. This is a blitzkrieg. You turn on your television, and Trump and Bannon, they know what they're doing. They're terrifying you. They want you terrified and confused. It's shock and awe. It's Hitler's blitzkrieg. Focus on what's really important, and that is love and yourself. Take care of yourself. Give half the day to yourself. If you're lucky enough to have a job and you're making money, half the day belongs to your boss. The other half belongs to you. What are you going to do from 7 till midnight when you come home from work if you're lucky enough to have a job? When you come home from work, that's your time. How do you want to spend it? Peak television? That's what they want you to do. They want you to just sit there and anesthetize yourself with television. Facebook, Twitter, is that how you're going to spend your time? Lighting up parts of your brain that can never be satiated. They've done studies. You go on Facebook, you go on Twitter, it's like a slot machine. They know exactly what they're doing. Mark Zuckerberg over at Facebook, they bring in slot machine experts to get you fixated on Facebook so that you're just locked in there. Your brain gets lit up, and then next thing you know, it's 5 hours later, and you can't sleep. There's nothing wrong with Facebook and Twitter, but you've got to have a Sabbath every day from these electronic devices. You have to love one another. You stop with the machines. They're okay. They're tools, but don't become a tool of the machine. You need to interact with other people. That's what you need to do. And obviously, sex is important. That's physical, but you need to connect with people on a spiritual level, and you have to start rewarding people on our side. We cannot cannibalize our own. So love in the age of Trump. I'm going to give you a call to action. These are the people. I'm actually salivating right now. I'm so Ooh. Worked up. Elizabeth Warren, Senator Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts. Love Senator Elizabeth Warren. Follow her on Twitter. She has a YouTube channel. Listen to everything Elizabeth Warren says. I grew up, my mother and father used to tell me, you don't have enough hours in the day to figure things out. Pick the right heroes. Ralph Nader, my mother and father used to say to me, do whatever Ralph Nader says. I'm lucky enough to do a radio show with Ralph Nader. Surround yourself with people who know right from wrong. Elizabeth Warren. Love Elizabeth Warren. Find out who Elizabeth Warren is. Google her. Follow her on Twitter and Facebook. Follow her YouTube channel. Follow Elizabeth Warren.
That's who you need to keep an eye on. That's today's message, okay? Elizabeth Warren. Love Elizabeth Warren. Spend an hour to find out about Elizabeth Warren. There is no utopia. There's no such thing as a utopia. Life is a constant struggle. Protect yourself. Simplify your life. Take care of your body. Exercise, walk 3 times a week. Have a vegan diet. You can't. I do it. I'm perfect. I figured it out. Took me a while, but I'm almost a vegan. All right. Love in the age of Trump. Two very important people in my life are here today. Lance Weiss and Angela Cobb.
Hello.
Hi.
I am shocked to discover that your generation of comedians, you don't understand why people become comedians.
We don't?
You don't. Okay. Comedians, you're two very funny comedians.
Mm-hmm.
Lance, is it all right if I call you a comedian?
You do whatever you want. Okay. Whatever makes you feel best.
I get into a lot of trouble with the female comics when I call them comedians.
It makes you feel really? Good. I'm all about.
Yeah.
No, I don't really. It's pretty hard to get in trouble with me, I feel like.
I love you, Andrew.
By the way, I love you. Can I talk about your opening remarks?
Yes. Well, let me just hang on for one second because I'm not done boring my audience. This is why you do comedy and you don't know it because you're so out of touch. Your generation is just.
Us youngins.
You don't know why you're doing this. You're doing this for love. And justice. That's it. And you don't even know it. You want love and justice. You either had too much love or not enough love when you were kids, and you either had too much justice or not enough justice when you were growing up, and you are now adults, and you discover that there's no love and no justice in your world, and that's why you're doing stand-up comedy, because it gives you love and justice, or the illusion of love and justice.
I'm actually pretty aware. Like, there's a Mel Brooks quote where he says similar stuff, and I like that a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah, he talks about, like, I feel kids, I mean, it's a little bit more one-sided than what you said, but I feel this way for sure. He's like, you know, they talk about, oh, performers and comedians didn't have a lot of love. He's like, no, I think a lot of the comedians, they had a childhood like full of love, and then they grow up and realize you only get your fair share as an adult. You don't get like what you used to get as a kid, so they seek it out. You know, like.
Thank you for bringing that up. I was about to quote Mel Brooks.
Oh, look at that.
Because, first of all, that's Angela Cobb.
Hi.
Angela Cobb is...
Is here.
My first time stand-up and storytelling show. It's monthly at QED in Astoria. It's the third Wednesday of the month, 9 p.m. And I guess this week, this time around, it's virginity.
No, that's the whole theme of the show.
It's like, always virginity.
It's all virginity law stories, yeah.
Okay. Ooh, we got a lot to talk about. So my first time.
People are sick of hearing about my virginity, so let's talk about your virginity.
is a monthly show at QED in Astoria. It's the third Wednesday of the month at 9 p.m., and every show is about losing your virginity.
Yeah, but I book, you know, different comics and storytellers each month, and it's, yeah.
Right. And do you do it as a podcast?
No, but I've been actually, I've been actually thinking about that and trying to make that happen because I think it might be a cool idea for
people. Well, if our producer, Alex Brazell, the CEO of Showbiz Studios, I know he's looking to get rid of me, to move me out of his lineup.
No, stop.
And maybe...
Is he going to take down that painting of you on the wall as well?
But I have, yes, I have actually toyed around with it, so I probably should do something about
that.
Well,
you should speak to...
I will.
To Alex, because I know he wants to get rid of me.
Well,
he wants to keep the name The David Feldman Show.
Yeah, but get rid of you.
Get rid of me.
Yeah.
I'm the weakest link. Twitter... Angela Cobb, at Angela Cobb, A-N-G-E-L-A, 2 B's.
It's a great name for show business because it's easy. You're not going to mess up Angela Cobb.
Right.
There's no misspellings. There's no pronunciations. No one's like Coob.
It's true. It really
is. Angela Coob. It's perfect. Right. Angela Cobb. You're not going to mess it up in pronunciation or spelling.
Like,
it's great.
I like it. Yeah.
It's a great showbiz name.
Look at that.
I have a slogan for you.
Oh, God.
Cobb, double B, like David Feldman's breasts. It's called gynecomastia.
I thought I noticed something about that they were a little bigger than usual.
When does the podcast start?
It's not. We're not.
Are you...
And your tweets have been featured at midnight, in the Huffington Post,
and all
ETC.
That.
Lance Weiss.
Hello. We're all here.
Lance Weiss is a New York City comedian. His website is lanceweiss.com, W-E-I-S-S. Lance Weiss. You can follow him on Twitter. at Lance Weiss on Twitter.
Perfect.
And your show is Gandhi, Is That You, which is one of the best shows in Manhattan.
I appreciate that.
It's really well produced.
No, thank you. It's a comedy show. We run ours Wednesdays at 9 as well, every Wednesday. February, we'll be doing the show 7 years.
Cool.
Awesome. So it's just, yeah, it's good. Yeah, over the time is built, you know. I'll just say that. It's a lot of work, and it's come to a pretty nice place. So, yeah.
Who are some of the young, funny comics coming up that you are...
What are we talking about? How age or how...
Well, who do you love right now
thousands.
In comedy?
There's so many funny
I know,
people.
But who especially do you love so much you hate them?
I don't know about hate them, but...
Bill Burr, I was listening to his Monday morning podcast, and I had to turn it off. I just said, God damn you. This is too good.
And it's just him, too.
I know. And I went, man, I can't, my ego can't.
My favorite comic in the whole city is Mike Dobbins.
Mike who?
Mike Dobbins.
Mike Dobbins.
See, that's the thing. You either know Mike or you don't, but if you know Mike...
I've heard the name, but I don't know him.
He's a legend. If you know Mike, he's been in New York, man, maybe, I don't want to be, I could be inaccurate, but maybe 13, 15 years. One of the funny, if you know Mike Dobbins, it's agreed upon.
How do you spell Dobbins?
Like Dobbins.
Alex, you're writing that down?
See if funniest dude around. He's my absolute favorite in the whole city.
See if you can get him in here in the next 10 minutes so I could get rid of these
two. Get him in. He's amazing. He's unreal.
Mike Dobbins.
And if you know him, you know.
It's Who else is funny?
I mean, if we're going, you know, it depends on how well-known or not.
Do you think is funny?
Rory Scovel's unbelievably funny.
All right. That's we all know that.
I started with Rory in D.C., so that's okay. That's younger.
Who's coming up that we should know about? Okay, we'll get back to you. Angela Cobb.
There's a lot.
I know. I was going to say, like, I sound like you're saying all these other people and you're being so nice, and I'm just sitting here like quiet, like, just me. I'm the only one. I would say in terms of people kind of like on my level coming up that I like a lot, Chrissy Mayer, very funny.
How do you spell Mayer?
M-A-Y-R.
And Chrissy is a female comic.
Yes,
Chrissy. It's interesting. You named male comics.
Wow.
Well, you know what? Actually, you know what's interesting? This is because I feel like there's a lot of funny male comics I know that I would say have been doing it longer. There's probably more male comics I know have been doing it longer that I'm like, they're funny.
There's more male comics in general.
But then like female comics, I for whatever reason, I'm more focused in on like female comics like on my level. I don't know. But Chrissy Mayer, Kristen Seltman is very funny. I introduced you to her at Fun Size and Venti.
Samantha Ruddy.
Samantha Ruddy is very funny too.
You ever have Micah Fox?
Oh, yeah, I just did. Mike is cool. Yeah,
she's super funny. Yeah, Amber Nelson.
We've had Micah Fox.
Mike, I did her podcast. Oh my god! And I just like ripped into each other.
Yeah, Micah,
she's cool.
I made the mistake with Micah of having her speak for all women.
Oh,
on this show.
Well, no one should speak for all anybody. Yeah,
yeah, I speak for all Jews. I speak for 80% of all Jews in this country.
That's cool. Leah Bonema.
Oh, Leah is great.
Leah
Bonema.
Who? I don't know who that is.
She's been around.
Yeah, she's
for a while,
been around.
Yeah.
A while. That's I always have a hard time when people
unbelievably
ask.
Unbelievably funny, yeah.
Yeah, she's really funny. Because when people ask, like, you know, about it, because you're always kind of thinking, like, well, who's been around a while, but then does everybody know about this person, and who do I like? So it's always
Ayanna
like,
Dookie.
Ayanna's great.
Dookie? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dookie, yeah.
Ayanna Dookie, yeah.
Is that her real last name?
D-O-O-K-I-E?
I think so.
Yeah.
Please tell me she's African-American.
She is, yeah.
She's very funny. No, she's very funny.
She's super funny.
I like her.
Her first name should be Anita. Anita Dookie. By the way, Trevor Noah has come into his own. So I proclaim as though it matters. The Daily Show has gotten really great. He has found it. And Samantha Bee.
Oh, everybody loves her.
Yeah, she's cool.
But, I mean, she's just getting better.
Yeah.
Samantha Bee is, you know, really.
Oh, Brooke Arnold is another one, too.
Who's Brooke Arnold?
She's a really funny comic, too. I like her a lot.
I don't know if I know
She's
her.
Another one to look
Are you
at.
Writing these down, Mr. Brazell?
I feel like now, but because I'm thinking more people, sorry, as I completely interrupt you and your whole thing. See, I am taking over the podcast, Alex. No,
somebody has to.
No, somebody has to lay down the law
I'm
here.
I'm not going to do it. I'm tired.
No, I'm tired. I'm trying to think of like male comics who are more up and coming, because like, there's plenty of like male comics who've been doing it a long time.
First off, I just view people as comics. I don't have...
Oh, no, me too, but I'm saying it. He pointed out that there was like a kind
I'm
of a
kidding, yeah,
division
yeah.
of what we were saying. Anyway.
See, my producer likes to go where lightning has already struck. I'm teasing you. You listening?
Yeah.
Is it all right if I can I complain to you? Is this okay?
Brian Grassi is a really good male comic. I'm thinking of my contemporary people. I really like him a lot.
See, I'm in the trenches. I'm just in the gutter.
The comedy trenches, or, I'm in the, or comedy, the life trenches.
I'm just in the trenches.
Okay.
And I'm looking up at the stars, but I'm in the trenches.
You're in there.
I had a nice run as a stand-up comic about before you guys were born.
No.
There was a time in my life when I could, I not anymore, but there was a time when I could call Conan and say, hey, I got a set ready.
You had it going.
You know, and then I took all these writing jobs and I became sclerotic and I put stand-up into the back burner, and God is now punishing me, and I'm running with the 20-year-olds here in New York to, you know, get my stand-up back on its feet.
Right, but that's good, because I think any good comic, no matter how long they've been doing it, I find the most comics who are real comics are going to go to an open mic even if they've been doing it for 20 years, or they're going to chill with, you know, they're going to do it right. You know what I mean?
Right.
But I wouldn't consider them up and coming comics because they've been doing it a while. That's the only thing.
Well,
we're all up and coming always, but
right.
You know.
Well, I'm on my way down.
He's on the way down, yeah.
I am. I mean, I know that.
But it's everybody just, is, really. I mean.
Well, but no. I want to be around young comics.
Right. Sure, I gotcha.
People my age are victims of their own expertise, and
some can be. Yeah,
that's interesting.
There's some comics that have been around for a long time. They're still progressive and going at it.
So my complaint about somebody who produces this show.
We're talking about podcasts, live shows.
I'm just talking about
any kind of event.
I think he's talking about one of us.
I'm talking about one of my producers.
Oh, okay.
I don't want to mention Alex Brazell by name.
I thought he was talking about one of us. I've done your show. It sucks.
I don't want to mention Alex Brazell by name, the owner and operator of Showbiz Studios. When I was living in San Francisco, I was a great comic.
There you go.
Purple Onion.
Well, no, this was before Mort Salt. I'm old. I was a great comic. And then I got plucked.
To be a writer.
By Tom Arnold.
Mm-hmm.
To write for Roseanne. And when you get plucked, you're...
Yeah, I was you gotta go.
But here's the thing about being a beautiful flower, a delicate carnation, tulip. I was so gentle and beautiful, and people would watch my... This was 25 years ago.
No, I
was a beautiful...
You still seem gentle and beautiful.
I was a beautiful flower on stage, and Tom Arnold plucked me. And what happens when you get plucked is you die. And what happens is then the flower gets folded into a book and pressed, and it becomes this permanent dead thing that is still kind of beautiful.
I think he's describing how I lost my virginity, actually. Totally.
But I was dead as a stand-up.
That's a different skill.
Yeah, and I could open up the book as a pressed flower and say, this is who I used to be.
Aww.
Right?
Yeah.
And I raised a family and became a comedy writer.
But you act like things didn't go well.
Well,
you wrote for every TV show that's possible.
But as a stand-up comic.
Sure. Well, you can't do everything.
I was a pressed flower.
Oh, I see. Well, I think that's even what I was getting at earlier, is people who are truly about being stand-up comics will somehow always make that, that'll be in their life somehow. Mm-hmm. Even if you feel like that was the pressed flower and your focus was in writing, or this is what I was getting paid to do, it is whatever. But because something in you was I have an identity as a stand-up comic, I got to go back to this. Am I wrong?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, you're right. You're right.
Well, everybody's got different goals.
You're always
too,
wrong.
You know?
Yeah, exactly.
I love stand-up as much as anybody, but if I got a great writing job I'd take off for 2 years and do that and make... You're talking about make money, build a following, have an audience,
Weird.
Or do bar shows for 8 people for the next year. You know what I mean?
See, this is where I actually feel a little bit like I might have been more successful if I was years ago, because I feel like I haven't quite developed other skills that are like if someone was submit a writing packet, I'd be I can't, I don't know. I'm really about doing it. I write a joke, I do it on stage, I perform in front of audiences, I talk to audiences after, then I do the next show. I'm really about that, but I need to diversify myself more, because in our generation, I feel like in our company, it's more about what you almost do. Where's your web series? Where's your podcast? Where's your, where's your Facebook Live video where you're just bullshitting? You know what I mean? And it's so... In a way, it's weird. I feel very like confident. Like I feel like stand-up comedy is like the language I speak, mm-hmm. but then it's like I'm not fluent in any other language.
Yeah, the problem is you have to make money at a certain
point. Right,
you
know exactly.
I mean? So it's like
yeah.
and not saying you know, if hopefully you take off as a huge stand-up, you make a lot of money, you sell. But a lot of people don't.
Right,
that route's not available to them.
Exactly,
so then it's like,
exactly.
Well, here's a writing job for
right.
$3,000 a week and benefits. You're like,
oh yeah,
pretty cool.
Yeah, no, I totally hear you. It's more for me. I think it's not even so much like I'd be like, if someone offered me a writing gig, I would more just be like, oh really? Because teach me how to like, what do I have to do?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But a writing job is, and I'm grateful for anybody who will pay me for my thoughts, and it is the greatest job.
It's a muscle.
Being a comedy writer is the greatest job.
Job.
It's a job, though.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
You have to go in on time
mm-hmm.
and toe the line and do what you're told. And it's the greatest. You're paid to read and write and hang out with people who hopefully are funnier and smarter than
mm-hmm.
you.
Right.
But it's a job.
Yeah, no, I, yeah.
Is stand-up a job?
Done well, yeah, I think so.
What do you mean?
All the people who are out there touring and really doing it. It's work. I don't think it's just, I mean, for some people, yeah, their routes may be a tad easier than, but look at the people who are super successful. They got a ton of dates. They have some of their podcasts. They're
right.
on, you have to get up in the morning, do radio.
Yeah,
it's a job.
Maybe, and there's a difference between work and a job, because when I hear job, I think you have to get up early. When I hear work,
yeah.
I more think you're going to work, but maybe you start working at noon. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so when I hear job, I more think regimented, oh, I'm bad at this because I have to wake up really early and be, you know. But work, I think, is slightly different than a job, in my opinion.
Justice in stand-up comedy. Is there really justice? I believe that there's justice in stand-up comedy. I also believe there's justice in podcasting. Not radio,
mm-hmm.
but podcasting.
Justice is in how in stand-up?
Garbage in, garbage out. The amount of work that you put into your stand-up or the amount of work that you put into your podcast, there's a reward at the end. The audience recognizes the work and the audience is your boss, and they know when you're phoning it in mm-hmm. stand-up comedy.
I don't
right?
know about podcasts, but I would say for stand-up, I think absolutely. Like, part of the reason I really like stand-up is, like, I've always considered myself a really good bullshit artist, and normally when I would do things in life, it'd be like, if I'm not naturally good at this instantly, like, okay, so this isn't for me. You know what I mean? And, like, stand-up was one of the first things where it's like, I had a natural aptitude for it, but I also realized, like, I couldn't bullshit my way through it.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I was like, okay, I gotta actually... You can't, you know what I mean? And I think that's why I like it, because it's the most, like, level playing field. It's like, it doesn't matter if they bring you up and it's like, you know, they've done this, this, and this, but if, like, in the first 5 minutes of your set you suck, they're not, no one cares what you've done. You know what
yeah.
I mean? It's very, like, I feel it's very, like, exact, you know, like, right now, did you do it or not? You know, it's in the moment of, like,
there's like a one-to-one correlation.
Yeah, which yeah. I like, you know, and it's I don't know. I think that's part of it, is very genuine and sincere. And like you said, they can tell when you're bullshitting, you know.
Lance Weiss is not Jewish. You're not Jewish.
No, you're not Jewish.
No.
God, that's got to be terrible, being mistaken for being Jewish.
I
don't think about it.
No, I'm more, because isn't your name Jewish?
Weiss or German?
It's German.
German.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I don't know.
Yeah, if you...
I'm more because the name. I didn't think you look like a Jew. I look like a Jew.
Whatever,
but I'm more for the name. Yeah, it was...
Well, there are a lot of German names. Like, if you read The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich 100 times the way I did, to me, it's The Godfather. A lot of people watch The Godfather.
Oh, yeah.
I can't read the sign.
It's upside down.
What does it say? I can't read it.
This guy's sitting handwritten notes upside down.
I've got my reading glasses.
Oh, I see what he said.
What did he say?
Can we say it out loud?
What did he say?
Well, I guess you don't know. So,
what are you saying? What's the sign?
Move on to sex
transition
talk.
Into the next
sex talk.
Yeah. Let's talk about sex.
And that's all for segment one.
All right, you're right.
Sex, Jews, and the Third Reich.
Wait
Go.
Till you hear the next segment.
Okay.
Bob Crane and Hogan's Heroes. That how it all will loop around.
Greatest autofocus. Rent autofocus.
Yep.
Rent autofocus. One of the greatest movies ever made. And it's about, by the way, what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Autofocus is about Bob Crane, mm-hmm. a really good guy.
Yeah. Well, yeah. How you define good. Yeah.
Who I believe got poisoned by Hollywood.
Oh, yeah.
Rent autofocus. Bob Crane was the star of Hogan's Heroes.
Mm-hmm. I love Hogan's Heroes.
You know why Hogan's Heroes is great? The lighting. I'm serious.
Well, that, yeah, but it's just great lit. General.
I never saw it.
Oh, it's awesome. You'd love it.
Hogan's like. Heroes.
It's the greatest.
Is a great show, and I attribute it great writing, great acting, but there is texture and a kind of...
You're right.
An actually, authenticity to the lighting
you're
that
right.
makes it believable.
You actually are right, yeah.
It's cinematic.
It
it's
is.
It's a really well done... Anyway, Bob Crane became very successful, and then... it was during the 60s. He was a victim of the 60s, fame, and money, and turned to became obsessed with pornography. And,
oh, wow.
And autofocus is right. the cautionary tale of what happens when you can have as much vagina as you possibly want. And what he had so much vagina.
Too much of a good thing.
Too much of a good thing. He had so much vagina in his face that he turned to pornography. It's like the reverse of what Lance Weiss and I, you know, it's like we watch so
when
much
porn. You can't get no vaginas, yeah.
He went from vagina to pornography.
Gotcha. Yeah, no, yeah, I know a little
bit. You got bored?
I know a little bit about it, yeah.
So anyway, Greg Kinnear, great actor, autofocus, rent it, great movie. Love in the Age of Trump. Let me ask you about slump busters. Have you heard of this term, slump mm-hmm. busters?
Like a carpet bagger?
Huh?
Is that like a carpet bagger? No, I've never heard of slump busters.
More like a carpet muncher.
Oh, okay.
No, I don't know what that meant.
I think I knew what you meant.
Okay, if you haven't been having sex for a while.
Oh, okay.
You want to put numbers on the board by going after a woman or a man who is easy.
Oh.
And you want to put an end to your cold streak. The idea is to get some confidence, get that glow. It's like hitting a home run off.
T-ball.
It's like hitting a home run off a AAA pitcher.
Oh,
it gives you
I
this
see.
Feeling oh. that you can do it again. So, have you ever had a slump buster? Have you ever been somebody's slump buster?
Probably.
Are you using that person? Can a man feel used? Can a man feel like he's a slump buster? Do women need slump busters?
I think, well, as you described it, that's why I went aw, because, like, to me, I can't, unless it's just because, I don't know. Yeah, I think a man could totally be a slump buster, like, given how it's, how you presented it. If somebody, to me, it takes, we've all like flirted with people for our own ego, but to actually like go further, in my opinion, and be like, I really don't, like, I'm not even really like attracted to you at all. You know, it just seems really, I don't know, contrived. I don't know.
Wrong, necessary, bad, immoral, using somebody?
Everybody's moral compass is different.
Yeah. Well, it isn't even about morals. See, I don't even think that I could. I'm trying to, like, maybe I'm just, I can't fake, I don't know, like, it just seems weird to me that, like, truly that's all it's about. It's like, I need to put, you know what I mean? Like,
you don't need to put, women don't need to put, not you, I'm not
oh,
you.
I needed to put, believe me, I've had sex just to put numbers on the board, so I guess I have, but I didn't, because I was a virgin for 25 years, so after, well, I was like, no, this is whatever, this is, I'm never going to see this person again, but I don't want to, like, end up in heaven with, like, how many people you sleep with,
one,
you know, yeah, anyway, but.
Let me ask you
but
about
I don't okay. consider it, like, I didn't do it out of, like, sympathy for them, or like, ew, they're beneath me, like, to me, the term slump buster sounds like, I'm doing this so I feel better about myself, because look at this loser, you know what I mean? So, to me, that's the part of it that's a little.
Lance Weiss, physiologically.
Okay. Physiology is what? It's like mental.
Your body.
Okay.
Your body. Yeah. While you're making love.
Okay.
You're not feeling like you're conquering something. But afterwards, when you pay her the money.
Oh, see, this
and
is
apologize to the pimp. No.
Like, I have worked hard.
Yeah. No, after the sex. It okay. feels like a conquest for men.
I thought during it felt like a conquest for
men. That's rape.
No, I don't mean like that. I mean, like, I thought that was part of just even how we're built. Like,
No, I was talking about what's going on in the control room.
Oh, okay.
Stop it, guys.
I didn't think after
that.
That
is
really?
Rape.
Okay. No, that's interesting. I more thought, I don't, well.
Showbiz.
Yeah, anyway.
I'm sorry, what were you?
I guess maybe I even just thought because, like, of how we're built, like, anatomically, I always more thought, like, is that the right word?
Yeah.
Okay, like, during it was more like of a conquest for you. You like how I did a little table rock thing, mm-hmm. you know, like a chair rock thing to show. Yeah, well, that's interesting, because I never thought about it that way, that, like, after, you're like, heh, heh. Like, I more thought it was during, you're like, heh, you know?
I don't know. To me, that sounds, I'm 58, so I need an emotional connection.
Oh, no, you can have an emotional connection and still feel that the way, I think, though.
I just don't think having sex, like, I don't remember. I don't think. There's a violence. Well, go ahead.
There is a violence that, like, well, I mean, before I.
I'm listening.
It's volatile. It's not, like, I think, again, I'm going to quote people because.
Sure.
So, like, I remember this was before I'd ever had sex, but I remember, like, reading some, I'm a big Marty Feldman fan, and it was some quote for him where he's like, you know, Marty Feldman, you know, Igor from Young Frankenstein?
Wow.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you know who he is, right?
Of course.
Yeah, I love him. He's like one of my comedy heroes.
It's my father.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Yeah. Anyway.
I wish I got his looks.
I kind of do too. No, I'm just kidding. Anyway. But
he's not my father.
No, I know he's not. Hello, Feldman is so. Anyway, next topic. But anyway, so he had a quote that was like something, you know, violence is in society. And he's like, you know, making love and making war are both violent activities. Mm-hmm. And I remember I was kind of like thinking about it like, but then like I finally had sex and I was kind of like, I get it from the perspective of violent as in it's volatile, not violent as in like. It's shooting someone, but violent, like chemicals are, you know, volatile and are going to explode, you know, like I feel that way. Like
I have daughters. I don't see sex as, I know that there was, I don't know.
I think I know what you're getting at because I even joke about this. That was part of, like, I had a hard time. Like, I feel like when I first started having sex, like, that because I'm 5'11", like I'm not used to as a woman like feeling vulnerable like physically at all, really. Like I walk around, like I don't feel like, oh, this person's gonna, you know, I'm kind of like, yeah, I'm told, like I don't really feel imposed upon, let's say. But like it was
I thought when you said you were 5'11", I thought you were like a chain of knockoff stores like 7-Eleven.
We should do that. My 5'11". Birth weight was actually 7-Eleven. Like this.
Really?
Yep. I was 7-11.
Would you like a Slurpee? Wow.
So I said to my mom when I was born, they were like, "Would you like a Slurpee?" Anyway, I think that's something that I've even still I think been trying to like rectify within myself, this feeling of like almost like vulnerability or like submissiveness, but at the same time like you're willingly, like it feels good. You know what I'm trying to say? It's like this vulnerability that you feel with someone. So I get what you're saying, but I think those two things can exist at the same time. You know what I mean? Like I think I think they can.
Good stuff.
Do you know about I, thou?
I don't know that either.
Martin Buber.
I don't know a lot of stuff in general.
Worshipping. You find God in other people.
Okay.
I've heard that.
Right?
I've heard that.
So I think sex is a form of worshiping God. So
I've heard that, yeah.
So when I perform cunnilingus, I'm really I'm going down.
You're
on God. I'm going down on God.
That you is become real. God?
No, I'm going down.
Yeah, I like
I'm
that.
God. I'm licking God.
Well, here's the interesting thing I always thought about.
I just lost every single listener. By the way, if your earphones just burst into flames when I say I'm performing cunnilingus, I'm God.
No, anyway.
I'm going to agree with you on this, though, a little bit, because I always find it fascinating. People believe in God, people don't believe in God, some people aren't sure if there's a God, whatever you want to call it. But there is a weird thing when people have sex that they yell, "Oh God,"
yeah.
Like regardless of their maybe religion or their, you know, it's...
And when you say God, you mean help police.
Yeah, yeah.
Somebody call the police. I can't help myself. That's why I masturbate all the time.
There you go.
That's a fascinating thing, though, that people, like, whether you watch movies or people yell it regardless of, the most unreligious person will yell that in the moment. So it's a weird. Is there some kind of connection to an actual whatever to another world?
And also
a God or a universe, a spiritual whatever.
And I remember even the other thing. Like I remember this is maybe embarrassing that, but I remember like looking this up like when I had started to have sex because in French, what is it like la petite muerte?
I was saying you're damn you
like die
I
when
was
you come.
Just gonna say
yeah. So
that.
Like to me, it's like okay. So
wait, what is it?
Like it's the little death, like when you come you die,
that's what they say.
Yeah, so like it's kind of, that's what I meant more about wrapping my head around this idea of like you're like enjoying it but at the same time like you're so like vulnerable to this other person that you're dead, you know what I mean? It's like yeah. Anyway,
wow. I just wrote, look what I wrote.
Little death kid.
It says little D-E,
wow.
And I was just in the middle of writing
anyway,
A to make a
good.
Note.
This is therapeutic.
I'm
going to
talk about snacks.
And
did
then
you write
she
that
just
down?
Brought up Petite Mort.
I think that's how you say it.
The Little
I'm not
Death.
French, so I don't know.
Shakespeare talks about this.
Yeah,
the Little
Death.
So what you're saying is when you have your orgasm, when the belt is around your neck, there's no more oxygen going to
everyone
the brain.
Does it different. Yeah.
No, that's not. Book ahead.
What? That's the only way you can have an orgasm is if you strap kids. Listen to me. There's a belt
kids.
In your closet. Listen to
Bing Crosby's kids. He beat them with the belt and then they masturbate.
There are a lot of children listening.
Go on,
there,
David. I'm
there's
sorry.
A reason there's a belt in your. No, don't do that. Do not. Do not. Do not do that.
Don't try any of this at home. Don't.
Showbiz.
Yeah, but if you do, if you.
Hashtag.
By the way, if you do walk into your closet and your adolescent son is unconscious, his name is Alex Brazell. He wrote that joke. Uh-huh. And Sue Showbiz Studios. They're an LLC. And
out
of Alabama.
LLC. I love it so much.
Yeah.
Okay, so go on though. I don't want to.
So that when you have an orgasm for that. Brief moment for a man, for a woman, mm-hmm. it just never stops. You are dead. Your whole body, you are dead, right? You've surrendered your, well, all that's left is.
Right, yeah. So I think that's more the idea that, like, we were even talking about this earlier when you said about, like, rectifying, like, feeling like you're conquering someone versus, but you're respecting someone. I think to me, that's what I found hard because I'm not used to being, like out of control, really, or like mm-hmm. I feel like for the most part I come off as kind of an alpha personality or just kind of like not, I don't know, people like, well, I'm not gonna fuck with Angela, I don't know. So to me it was kind of like jarring almost, like, you know, because it was like, this is nice but this is weird, do I trust this person enough to even be in the, you know what I mean? So like it, but I think that's,
I mean, what a time we had.
That's huh. Yeah, we did. We had a good time, me and Lance. Yeah.
Nothing.
Anyway, oh, really? Was no, this during no. Hurricane Katrina?
Katrina. That's what it should have been.
All the hurricanes.
I was a freshman in college during Katrina, so that's probably when it should have been. Like, anyway. But
you were a freshman in college during Katrina.
That
isn't that
first.
How you lost your virginity?
No, I lost it during Hurricane Sandy, years later.
Get the hurricanes.
But
right.
Anyway, people are sick of hearing about this. Anyway, my point was,
you lost your virginity during Hurricane Sandy.
Yes, I was
that
25.
Would be 4 years
yes.
ago.
Yes. Okay. So anyway, hi Lance, how you doing?
I remember that.
Yes, you were there too.
What were you doing?
All of you. Wow.
We were all crazy. Everybody had sex. I remember Chris Christie hugged Barack Obama. Everybody everybody got horny during.
They had sex during. Oh, poor Obama. Anyway, so
you've been in the game for. Almost 5 years.
Yeah.
4.5 years.
Yeah. But anyway, the point I guess I was trying to make was that.
Let me just process that for a second.
That's where the emotional connection comes in. Because you can have sex, like, I don't feel emotionally vulnerable when I have sex with somebody I don't give a shit about. It's just mm-hmm. like, whatever. You know what I mean? It's almost, you feel more vulnerable when you actually give a shit about somebody. You know what I mean?
Oh, wait a second. So you lost your virginity because you thought you were going to die?
No. No, that's actually not why. No, that's not why.
Where were you?
How specific are we getting here? I was on a futon. No. No.
Where else are you?
Yeah, where are you, man?
There's other spots?
No, I'm talking about, like, so there was a hurricane. You were in Jersey.
No, I wasn't in Jersey.
Where were you?
Why would I be in Jersey?
Well, hurricane. We're talking, what hurricane?
Sandy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sandy. It was named after Bruce Springsteen.
She was out at Rockaway.
Asbury Park.
At the Rockaway Taco.
No, that's where he was.
Just to help you, people are very sick of hearing about this. I just want you to, like, I don't mind talking about it, but I think a lot of people are sick of hearing about this.
Well, not on my show.
I feel like we've talked about it on your show.
I have things like that I talk about too, and I feel like I've just
beat
it to death.
But it's funny. To me, it becomes almost funny. It's like I try to then incorporate everything into, like, you think I talk about it too much? Look, I can incorporate the election into my Virginia.
Yeah.
but I'm sorry, David. Go on.
No, you go ahead.
It's like a musician playing the greatest hits.
But
people love the greatest
hits. Hurricane Sandy is my Hey Jude. It's like, nah. And a bunch of people pop out.
You're
like, it was me. It wasn't. And I'm like, no, it wasn't you. Okay.
I'm just wondering if we're all, like, if I can get laid using Hurricane Sandy, like, oh, Trump is president.
All the disasters.
Oh,
look at this.
Well, yeah. Well,
all that matters is we love each other.
Yeah.
Well,
zip, flop, suck.
Zip, flop. I love flop. Okay. Well, with the election thing, that's why I even said about, like, make virginity thing related to the election, because the last election. You know, it was during Sandy, like, basically, well, a little after, you know what I mean? Like, that was the last, like, presidential, you know, Obama got reelected. Yeah. So when this kind of rolled around, I remember being, like, feeling like, oh, like, I feel kind of like, oddly nostalgic, and then the results of the election made it even worse. I'm like, holy shit, I thought I'd be sad for other reasons on the night. Now I'm like, this is... But also,
you
too,
get excited during every major disaster.
Every major disaster. Anyway, but...
apparently, when we get wet, so does Angela.
There you go.
Have you done that joke? No, there's a reason.
You hack. No, I'm just kidding.
When you said, there you go, have you done that joke?
You're like, there's a terrorist threat. It's a red level alert.
Right. No, but and other people have even joked about that with me. And anyway, I think that, I do think, though, with what you were, I don't know, maybe this is what you're getting to about using Trump or that kind of thing. I do think that it's made people put into perspective certain things. Like, one of my friends even joked with me, like, when Hillary lost the election, because the guy I had lost my virginity to is a big Hillary supporter, too. She was like, look, like, it's going to bring you to back. You know what I mean? I feel like families have probably reconciled over shit, you know, or, like, maybe people have started to make, like, put things aside. It's like, look what we're dealing with here, you know? Look what's in charge now. Let's, maybe we can, I'm sorry, I cut you off last year on the street, you know? Or, like, you know, so.
I was at the Javits Center the night.
Hillary,
I was there.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
With Triumph the Insult.
I was in Rockefeller Center, like, right in the ice rink where they were doing all the coverage.
Really?
Really? Yeah.
I took pictures of women at night at the Javits Center. There was no way you could walk up to a woman that night and say, hey, you know, let's have some crate.
That's because you actually are respectful.
Have you ever had a slump buster, Lance Weiss?
No.
Have you ever been a slump buster?
No.
Could you have sex with a woman and never call her again?
No, I'm not the kind of guy.
Wait, but see, I don't think that means it's a slump buster. I think that's just whatever. We had sex and that's it. Like, I don't think... I don't know. This whole slump buster thing implies that it's almost like a... It implies a certain meanness of, like, the one person feels like they're, like, above that person, like, maybe physically or whatever, and it's like, all right, I threw them a bone, they should be grateful, bye, you know what I mean? Or, like, I don't know.
Do you owe somebody, if you have sex with somebody, what do you owe them besides the $50? No. What do you owe a person you just had sex with?
I think it depends on what the relationship was before you had sex. In other words, I think, like, if you guys were, like, good friends for a while, let's say, maybe you've known each other a while, and there's already, like, a certain sense of respect for each other or whatever, then there's probably, like, you know, some sort of, like, you're at least going to text them the next day or something like that, you know, versus if it's somebody like a Tinder date you just met, I think it's kind of expected that, like, it could go either way. You know what I mean? I don't think there's any obligation if you don't really know each other or, like, you know, I think it's more about kind of going into it what the relationship was versus... You know what I mean?
Does that well, your generation understands. It's much different than my generation.
Cultures have changed.
But I'm like sappy and romantic too, is what I'm saying.
But if a guy has sex, if you have sex with a man, does he have to call you or do you have to call him afterwards?
But like, what's the context?
I don't think anybody owes anybody anything in life.
I think it's about the context of the relationship, sex or anything, everybody expects
things to happen for like, but no one owes anybody anything.
If somebody
opens a door for you, you don't technically, it'd be nice if they said thank you, but they didn't ask to have the door open, they didn't, you know. No one owes anybody anything. We all just expect things because we're like, well, I did that for you, why didn't you do that for me, or
I think,
you know, whatever.
That's why I think it's more about the context of the relationship. Like if yeah, I think it's about the context of the relationship. Like, if I had sex with somebody who, like, I don't really know that well, and it was fun, whatever, but then, like, he never texts me, he doesn't contact me, I'm not going to be like, oh, my God, because there was no real, like, emotional history or connection to begin with. Do you know what I'm saying? Versus somebody that maybe you like, and you're like, oh, okay, like... So I think it's more about the context of the relationship versus... I don't think it's like, if you have sex, you must do this. It's, you know?
You know what?
Does that make sense?
It's almost like if somebody... like, we're friends, right? I don't see a lot. But
me,
I see
you and me?
Yeah, I see.
All right, let's have sex. I'll have sex. I see you around.
No, but it's like, granted, I'm bad at responding to messages in general, but like, if I saw you, you know, I've been on here a couple times, I see you at a show, I know you for the last couple years, the last few years, and if I see you, you don't owe me anything, but if we're at a party, and then you, I'm like, oh, well, and you like, and you didn't say hi to me, or like, or if I emailed you about something, you didn't email me back, because it's like, you know, I'd be like a little hurt. Like, right. I thought we were like, you don't owe me anything, but I would feel hurt.
You know what else it is, too? I think you can also, because even like you said, I'm not the best at responding to things or whatever. I think it also depends upon the person, because once you know someone well enough, you know almost like their texting habits or their response habits. Mm-hmm. You know, if this person responds super quick, then you become paranoid if they don't respond right away.
Yeah,
like, wait,
yeah,
what's this person doing?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
I
versus someone who doesn't text back at, like, 3 days, but that's just who they are. You know what I mean?
See, I filter everything through class struggle. I apologize. I'm 58. I view everything through corporate manipulation.
Okay.
So...
You're 58?
I'm 58.
Oh, you look good.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I was one of those guys who was ugly in his 20s, 30s, and then in my 50s.
I like that.
Uglier.
I get uglier. I get so uglier.
No, can't wait to see the 60s hold.
So here's the thing with me. I was with the same woman for pretty much 30 years. Mm-hmm. I never cheated.
It's like my parents did.
Yeah, I never flirted.
Mm-hmm.
Fell in love with somebody in the mid-80s. Thank you, God.
Oh,
that's
God.
It.
Yeah.
I'm done. Here's my penis. Here's my libido. Mm-hmm. You got it. I'm the luckiest man in the world. Aww. And now, like, I'm a guy in a coma who suddenly woke up 30 years later.
Right.
And I'm going, oh.
The game has changed.
That's how, because my parents divorced 30 years, too, and that's how they feel.
When I was in the game, as they say, it was a different country.
Mm-hmm.
It was, Reagan was just ruining it. But now I find you meet a woman and they don't have health insurance or they're broke. And you go, really? I'm going to have a real, you begin to work, like you just can't have sex with somebody who doesn't have health insurance or is struggling financially or is... I just don't. And when you say to me, you're young people, and you say to me, you don't owe anybody anything,
mm-hmm.
and you don't have to call them the next day, I can't help but feel that you have been programmed.
Hold on, I'm checking my Instagram account
with the Bumble and the Tinder and the Grindr that you've been programmed by the corporate elite.
Mm.
To treat your sexual partner as some disposable item made in China.
But see, this is where I feel you cannot feel disposable if you don't have an emotional... Like, I felt disposable by people that I really cared about because mm-hmm. they... Like, you can't be hurt by somebody you don't really give a shit about, in my opinion. So to me, it's like... If somebody I slept with once never gets back to me, I'm not going to feel disposable because who gives a shit? You know what I mean?
But don't you think you're being programmed to treat people as though they're disposed, like they're iPhones that can be replaced? That's not how I grew
our
up.
Our culture's like that for sure, no question.
It wasn't like that when I was...
No question
well,
our culture's like that.
You know,
you even go
also-
to appliances. Like, if these microphones broke... you know, 50 years ago, mm-hmm. somebody would fix the parts. Now, like, ah, fuck this
but
microphone,
see,
I'll go buy
really,
a new one.
But also, see, that's where I think it's both good and bad, because you know how people on Facebook, they'll always post that meme on Facebook of the old couple holding hands, and
yeah.
how'd you stay married for 80 years? uh-huh. We grew up in a generation where if something broke, you fixed it. You didn't throw it mm-hmm. out. It's like, that's dumb. I'm sorry. If you fall out of love, goodbye, you're divorced. Like, you know, that you have to also be realistic about things. You can't, like, there are plenty of people who stay because you know, they're miserable, and just because it's like, well, we're going to fix this. It's like, you have to... I think it's like there's a gray area. So I think on the one hand, we've lost a little bit maybe of the like respect or decorum of like courting or whatever the hell it is.
Mm-hmm.
But also on the other side, it's also we've gotten more real about it and less of the fakery of pretending. Like, let's face it, like there's people who dated back in the day who like waited to have sex. They wanted to have sex on the first date, but they mm-hmm. didn't think they should or something like that. You know,
what if you're wrong?
I could be wrong. I'm not.
What if you're wrong?
Yeah.
What if?
I'm not saying everybody wanted. I'm saying that I think there's a gray area that there's been, given this sort of disposability element you talked about, I think there's both good and bad aspects of that.
You're right. You know, there's a narrative that your generation, Angela Cobb,
yes, my generation,
is telling itself. But are you telling it to yourself, or are you being indoctrinated by the richest 1%, by the corporate elite, to believe that sex is a physical act, that you are detached from it,
mm-hmm.
and that it's not necessarily love, and that way you eventually don't care if 20 million people lose their health insurance? I mean that. I'm being absolutely serious.
Again, that's where I think it's all a case-by-case basis, because I feel... What happened?
We're getting the wrap up. So okay. Go ahead.
I feel like it's not about being like, I think you can be in love and have sex with someone, and then also like have sex with someone and be detached because you're not in love with, you know what I'm saying? I think
it's the whole world we live in. I mean, you even look at grammar's not even corrected on major news sites because it just goes down the feed.
Yeah.
And it's not a two-page brilliant article written by, like, I've blogged for some like pretty good sites and I'm not an expert. And I'm, you know what I mean? Like a lot of times a blog written by like CNN or like Forbes, or it's written by like a 21-year-old who and it just goes down the feed. Yeah. Like the whole world is disposable now. That's what we're living in.
Yeah.
You know?
Actually think starting to have sex later in life actually on that regard actually helped me a little bit, because like I kind of have my own ideas, I feel like, to a certain extent about like how I feel about... Mm-hmm. You know, like because I didn't have like a conventional experience where it's like, you know, I had sex with my first boyfriend when I was 16 and then we went to, you know, so like I feel like because I grew up feeling so like almost like alien to a certain extent about a lot of stuff, like, well, these people are like, how does this even happen? Mm-hmm. That I really kind of felt like I did it all kind of, you know, now I'm navigating it myself, which I think almost gives me less of the like shit that people feel like men and women, you know, like we have to do this or we have to do that, you know.
I always thought love was being selfless.
Yeah, I think
the theme of the show is love in the age of Trump. And this is an age of selfishness. It was an age of selfishness when Ronald Reagan took office. Mm-hmm. We became an age of selfishness. Love is selflessness.
Mm.
Love is not individualism. Love is... you lose yourself in another person.
No, that's codependency. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, that's a... yeah, that's is true. That... is that a coping, is the term codependency?
No, I think that there's a selflessness in love, but I also think you have to have a strong sense of self to be in love. That was pretty good.
Okay. Hey, Alex, you're giving me the wrap-up sign, and I want to get to something. So what are you talking about? Who's here? All right. I feel cheated. Want to get to, you hear that little
this that inside little show, Briz.
That's when you can tell I'm hurt, when you hear, when I make a sound like that.
I'm sorry, it's because I talk too much. Go ahead.
No, man. You know, I by the way, Angela, not to embarrass Lance Weiss here,
I've had a great time.
You're a genius.
Thank
so are you.
No, I'm not. I'm really not.
She,
I don't know a lot of stuff.
Oh, that's sweet of you. Thank you.
I'm just out here trying to navigate the world on my own.
I learned a lot. By the way, I was just...
You know when you said, what would my mother brag about? She'd say, Angela's a genius, so why can't you pay her rent? Or why can't she get up in the morning?
How about this? How about this? Maybe I'm the genius. Angela has something to prove.
Ooh! Ooh! I just probably have undiagnosed autism. Go ahead. Go ahead, Feldman. I'm sorry.
No, it's been diagnosed. Our listener... No. You are... no. So, Laszlo... I could keep calling him Laszlo because I watched The Third Man. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. My ex-wife always used to bring this up whenever I was having my daily panic attack. He was a psychologist, Abraham Maslow. He wrote a paper in 1943 called A Theory of Human Motivation. Mm-hmm. He studied Eleanor Roosevelt, Frederick Douglass, Albert Einstein, Jane Addams, who I really don't know that much about, Jane Addams. Jose Arroyo always used to talk about Jane Addams. And he looked at neurotic people, emotionally stunted people, and then he studied the healthiest 1% of our country. And there are steps to, that you have to accomplish.
The triangle.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
The hierarchy of needs.
Mm-hmm. Do you know about this, Angela?
I was going to say, see, that's why I'm a genius, but I'm not that smart. No, I know a little bit about it. Yeah, I know a little bit about it.
I love the way you said that. Alex, can you just cut that as the opening for our show, as the sting for our show?
Next up.
You should have your own sitcom, the way you just said
Thank you. Anyway, but please talk about the hierarchy of needs. And no, I probably don't know as much about it as Lance does.
And... love is number three. First is physiological needs. So in the age of Trump, how are we going to survive in the age of Trump? And according to Abraham Maslow in 1943, first you focus on your physiological needs.
Breathing.
Your breathing.
Water.
Your body.
Shelter. Be next.
Yeah. You put on... the oxygen mask first before you take care of your baby.
Sure.
right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Physiological needs. Healthcare. First thing, I've always said this in America, universal health insurance.
Sure.
So this is really important, folks. There's a lot of noise out there. Number one, Medicare for all. Medicare for all. Medicare for all. That is the only thing you should be focused on politically. Medicare for all. That is your physiological need. You're being, it's shock and awe right now. There's a blitzkrieg. Focus on Medicare for all. I know Black Lives Matter. They really do. I know gay rights matter. I know Israel and the Palestinians. That has to be solved. Medicare for all. That's all that matters. Medicare for all. Then it's safety needs. Number two is safety needs.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel safe?
And there's different aspects of that too, because you can feel emotionally safe and physically safe. I think there's layers to that, yeah.
I feel pretty good.
You feel safe?
Oh, he's literally
I don't care.
I feel all right now, yeah.
I don't get wrapped up in that stuff. Like, I don't care who the president, like, I don't like Trump, but I don't care if whoever's in there live my life based off that who's in there.
Mm.
Maybe that's bad. People argue that's bad. I tap out.
I think, you know what, I will say this. I think that, and not to sound like some kind of, I don't even know, but it's funny. I think there are people with Trump who more, not everybody has the same luxury with Trump, I feel. Like, and I'm saying this like as a white mm-hmm. woman, obviously. There's something like Trump says about women, whatever. And I'm like, oh my God, yeah, that's bad. But at the same time, like, I get that, like, you know, I am not in any way, shape, or form, like, affected by this as directly as, like, sure. you know, a black woman, a Muslim family, or, you know what I mean? So, like, mm-hmm. I think to a certain extent, some of us have more of a luxury
that's a good point.
Like, let's see what happens. And mm-hmm. some people are like, no, let's not. You know? Like,
I don't want to see what happens. I just right. don't. I don't.
Oh, I get it.
I don't care what's. I try not right. to live my life based off what the banks do, what the government does.
Unless, like, you're in my family, like, we're dating mm-hmm. or, like, we're really good friends, like, I'm kind of like, I don't, like I said earlier, almost, like, unless it's, like, a real intimacy there, I'm not going to really give a shit that yeah. much, but it's also obviously going to affect me because he's mm-hmm. the president.
Well, what he's doing is he's making us feel less safe.
Yes, that I could see.
The carnage, the human carnage that he talks about in the inauguration. He is.
Well, he just isolated us in yeah. that
well,
speech.
When you feel, when you don't.
He treats America like an abused spouse. That's basically right. it.
So let me tell you what safety is, folks. I'm going to get to all these and then we're going to end the show.
Thanks,
I'm going to get
David.
To safety, love and belonging, esteem, self-actualization, and self-transcendence, however you pronounce it. This is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I'm going to wrap it up, Alex, but I want to get to this, if you don't mind, okay? This is important, and this is one of our best shows, but... I'm being replaced by Marty Feldman. He passed away, unfortunately. Okay, safety needs. Number two. Okay, hierarchy of needs.
This is great.
Safety is money. Safety is money.
Security.
Safety is money. Not the police.
Mm-hmm.
Not the military. Money. Focus on money. Focus on the 1%. We are the 99%. Occupy Wall Street will go down in history as one of the greatest movements since the populist movement. Hmm. Focus on money. Who's got it? Who's manipulating you with it? Who's holding money in front of you and depriving you of it? After Medicare for all, focus on money. Who is getting rich off you and exploiting you? Unionize. Pay attention to the minimum wage. Focus on who is stealing your money. That is safety, not the police. The police are God bless the police, but they work for the richest 1%. Mm-hmm. When you get your home foreclosed on, the sheriff kicks you out. The sheriff mm-hmm. comes.
Yeah.
It's true. Yeah.
The police work for the corporate state. I love the police, some of them,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but safety is money. Number three, love and belonging.
I always thought love was higher on the I didn't know it was that far down.
You get when you are physically after you take care of your physiological needs,
being wanted
and
in the group,
and your feelings. Yeah, okay. And you, after number one is physiological, number two is safety. Mm-hmm. Once you feel safe,
that's true.
Three is love. You know, a woman will not love you unless she feels safe around you, Lance.
Or have money?
No, but see, that's where I disagree about the money thing.
Well, there you go. That's interesting.
I think safety... Well,
this is one of our best shows, Alex, and you're giving me the wrap-up sign.
When people say safety and security, though, I don't think money. Like, when it comes to dating, I think I feel emotionally safe with you. I can love you. Mm-hmm. I don't think it has anything to do with, like, you know, I could care less who's going to... You could buy me a slice of pizza. Good for you. You know what I'm saying? Right. So, yeah. Go on.
After love comes esteem. Well, I don't know about that. I would think I've been trained that you need self-esteem first.
Mm. Well, it's higher. Like you want to love is you want to be wanted in the group, and like and then esteem is like I'm head of the
right.
group.
Love and belonging.
Yeah,
love and belonging. We need after safety, we need to love and belong. We need to be part of a community.
Mm-hmm. Esteem.
Go ahead.
Esteem. You've made it to the top of the group because that's where do you go from there? I'm one of the group. Now I'm in charge of the group.
Right. Belonging. Facebook gives the illusion that you're belonging mm-hmm. to something. I do love Facebook.
No, but I agree there what you said.
But it's the illusion that you belong mm-hmm. to something. I you know, on Twitter, but mostly Facebook. I've made friends on Facebook and we've shared information. But it keeps lighting up parts of my brain that cannot be satiated. Mm-hmm. By the way, podcasting different. This is a real community. People, it is. It's different than Facebook. Number four is self-esteem, then self-actualization, mm-hmm. and then self-transcendence. I don't know how to pronounce transcendence. We'll continue this conversation. We have to wrap it up. I want to thank you. I've been honestly depressed and trying to figure.
Have you really?
Yeah,
a lot of people have.
Yeah, a lot of people have.
And I keep struggling with...
Because of this stuff or because of winter?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't watch the TV. Mm-hmm. I read about it and then I watched clips on YouTube.
It's really messing up a lot of people.
But I don't know if it's... It is. You mm-hmm. know, it's like I always wonder how psychiatrists treated people during Nazi Germany.
Mm. Like, yeah.
But wow. I gotta wrap it up. Angela Cobb.
Yes.
People follow you on Twitter.
Mm-hmm. At Angela Cobb.
And you do a monthly show.
My first time.
It's about losing your virginity. Mm-hmm. And it's a QED in Astoria.
Yes.
Third Wednesday of the month. It's at 9 p.m. Virginity Loss Stories.
Yep.
And, QED in Astoria. I love.
It's great.
Cambry.
It's great. Mm-hmm.
Cambry, it's a great space.
Christian Finnegan. God bless them.
It's a great space.
God bless. Mm-hmm. God bless them. QED in the story. If you want to support great comedy in America, when you're visiting New York.
I want to have you on the My First Time show.
Well, when I lose my virginity,
that's
on
the
come on.
Last time show.
Yeah. The last time. That is a good idea for the last time you had sex. Yeah.
You've
done it?
No, I'm saying, but that's a good idea in
new
general.
New segment.
Yeah.
I more thought like you had sex, then you died. You know.
And Angela Cobb, follow her on Twitter. Her tweets have been featured on At Midnight in the Huffington Post. And Lance Weiss.
We got to wrap it up. LanceWeiss.com. That's it.
Gandhi, is that done. You? How do we promote Gandhi, is that you?
Just LanceWeiss.com. It's all there.
All right.
Make it simple.
Friend me on Facebook. Light up my brain for a nanosecond by friending me on Facebook and following me on Twitter. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. We got great information at davidfeldmanshow.com. Love in the Trump age. Love Elizabeth Warren. Find out who Elizabeth Warren
is. She is a beast.
Find out. Google Elizabeth Warren, Senator Elizabeth Warren. Follow her on Twitter. Follow her on Facebook. Follow Elizabeth Warren. Do what Elizabeth Warren tells you to do.
She's amazing, yeah.
Do what Elizabeth Warren tells you to do. Simplify your life. Get rid of the clutter. Get rid of the noise. Do what Elizabeth Warren tells you to do. Medicare for all. Medicare for all from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us. Medicare for all.
That's our show. Thank you for listening. We've got a lot going on over at davidfeldmanshow.com. Please go to the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com and root around. We've got a lot of interesting stuff. I'll talk to you later.